on deck, everybody. It's Monday night. We're on every Monday night, 9 to 11, as some of our loyal viewers will know. Tweet us about the whole show at On Deck Show, and we will hopefully get a response to you. Tonight, we're going to be talking to about the Giants with a big win over New Orleans, the Jets with a surprising, I guess, win over Jacksonville.
It's just, they're so boring to watch.
Yeah, it sucked to watch.
They did win.
Yeah, they did win. We're going to talk about the Knicks tape, which continues to roll because they're fucking awesome.
Tape City.
And we're gonna take a good look at baseball because shit hit the fan this week.
It has.
It's gotten hot.
Rookie record deal.
Active,
which is ridiculous.
Active, going down. Active week in everything, really.
Yeah, even hockey.
No,
it was active. No. They had talks and then they failed again.
Yeah, they
spoke. They canceled the rest of the game.
Let's speak without officials to get something official done. Except nothing's gonna happen.
Oh no, man! They fucking run that league.
We've already spoken too much about hockey.
You're right. I'm sorry.
You know what? Before we get started, shout out to the Chief. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Chief.
It is December 10th.
Happy birthday to the Chief.
Happy birthday.
Hail to the Chief,
indeed.
So,
the Giants, I mean.
Giants.
The David Wilson.
The David Wilson.
Laying the backflip show.
Yeah, what a tool.
Yesterday.
What a tool.
Hey, everybody's hating on him. I'm like, yo, you got to stop doing that, man.
Nah,
you got to stop that shit.
What would you do if he tore his ACL on the second one?
I'd be like, you're a fucking moron. But until then, I was like, oh, look at him flip.
When Braylon Edwards did a backflip.
He scored a touchdown and he flipped.
Everyone killed him. I'm just going to say that.
Yeah, I know. And everybody
he's a Jet.
I have not heard a recap of the show, even. I mean, of the game, where somebody didn't say, stop doing that, young man. You got to stop doing that backflip thing. It's ridiculous. We all picked the Saints to win, right?
Yeah, we did. Yes, and then I believe after that will be the reason the Giants win, because we all picked the Saints.
The last time we all picked the Saints?
I'm pretty sure they lost too.
So let's stop picking the Saints. Well, I mean, I don't care what happens to the Saints. But yeah, right. For DJ Whitehot's sake.
For DJ Whitehot.
We won't pick the Saints from here on out.
Did you think they were going to put up a 52 burger on them?
No, I mean, I could have seen either team.
Well,
catch
actually,
that. I would have thought that the Saints would have done it before the Giants. Just,
I didn't think they were going to, but if you would have told me Saturday that the Giants are going to drop 52 on the Saints, I probably would have been shocked.
No, the Saints defense is fucking terrible.
Hot water trash, to quote the great Patrick Kenny.
Yep.
When he led 327 yards to one player.
Wow.
David Wilson.
That's not...
327 all-purpose yards.
That's not how you win games.
No.
Keep returning touchdown right in the beginning.
Yeah.
Right,
Eli threw a pick. Eli was derped to start the game. Eli derped out, and then David Wilson was like, it's cool, bro. It's cool, bro.
Got this.
I think I like David Wilson.
Yeah, but the only thing with the Giants is like the Giants were...
As long as he's not crying.
The Giants had a dominant game.
Yeah, they killed
this week, right? What happened last week?
Here we go. I have a question. Does this say more about the Giants or more about the Saints?
Well, I'm not talking about... I don't know, just, you know. Both. I think it's both.
I think it goes both ways.
Both teams played to their extreme potentials because the...
Thank you.
The offense... The Saints' offense wasn't terrible. But they just, like you said, their defense is water trash.
Yeah, and
hot.
And the Giants...
The Giants,
I mean, the Giants, the...
27 to New Orleans is good. Put it that way.
Yeah, that's true. You know, that's... But, I mean, their offense went off. The Saints couldn't stop.
Offense and special teams.
Yeah.
I mean, Lawrence Tynes did miss a field goal, which is hilarious, from like 36 yards. Yeah, right? There was only really one time, though, when the game was in question for the Giants. When Darren Sproles scored that one touchdown, the receiving touchdown.
It was very early. The game was over in the third. I mean, at least to me, it was over in
the third. Well, once I got to more than one touchdown again, it was like, all right, this is pretty much it.
So what I said before, Scala raised his question over there. The Giants this week were what? Dominant, right?
Yes, dominant.
What were they last week?
Against the Skins?
Yeah.
We didn't really get to watch it, which sucked.
Yeah, well, we were here. But I'm saying, but they were... They lost to a team they should have beat because they're better than.
Which is what the Giants do.
Okay, and then the game before the Redskins game, what happened? They played the Packers.
And they destroyed them. Exactly. What have we said?
And then, hold on. And then what happened before they played the Packers?
What was before the Packers?
The Bengals. They got shit-canned by the Bengals. So what's going to happen next week?
Against Atlanta.
Yeah.
In Atlanta. See, you guys both think they're going to win. I mean, they're going to lose. I think the Giants are going to win.
So you think finally now is when they show consistency this season?
No, but they're playing another good team.
Yeah, but
that's what it comes down to for me.
They're a good
team who lost to Carolina this week. So I mean,
yeah. So how good really are they? that everyone has been saying.
They're 11. Were they 11-2?
11-2. But I mean, out of every 11-2 team I've ever heard of, no team has been as criticized for not really being an 11-2 team as the Falcons have been.
Okay, but even if they're in, you know, they're still a very good. They're still a good team. Put it that way.
Yeah, I mean, they're an above average team.
Yeah,
honestly,
which is in the Giants' favor.
Yeah, exactly. It's in the Giants' favor. But I'm telling you, it's not like they're playing a great team and they're going to rise to the occasion. It's the Falcons. They've destroyed the Falcons.
No, but in terms of rise to the occasion, that's more evidence for them doing that if they win, because the occasion, the game is still a big game. The Falcons are still 11-2, regardless of how good their makeup is outside of that.
Too.
But it's a big game because of the fact that it's an 11-2-2 team squaring off against the fucking 8-5 team.
Yeah, but last week was a big game too.
Yeah, but
you can't use the big game excuse. Last week was Last week was a divisional game.
Yeah, but either way,
where you could have put the division away, or at least in one team, you could have put the division.
But the Falcons are a better team than the Redskins are too. That's what I'm saying. It's a combination of both those things.
Yeah, they're better. I don't think they're that, you know, amazingly much better than the Redskins, to be honest with you.
No, but they're better.
Yeah, they are, but I don't think.
Put it this way,
I don't think they're that much better. That it's like the Giants.
No, but the
like
difference is that you wouldn't be surprised if Atlanta.
Goliath.
You wouldn't be surprised if Atlanta won, whereas Washington winning was a little more surprising.
Yeah, but only that's only because it's Atlanta's at home. If Atlanta was playing in New York,
there's no shot Atlanta wins in New York.
No way Atlanta would win against the Giants at home.
That's fair.
Absolutely not. You saw what happened last week. You're in the playoffs.
Either way. I think that the Giants are going
to
win this game.
All you need to know about...
I don't know, man. I can't pick them because they're the most inconsistent fucking team in the entire league. They shit-stomp the 49ers, and then the Bengals throw all over them, and then they kill the Packers, and then they lose to the Redskins. I don't know, man. They just don't make sense.
Yeah, but week to week, they've just faced great team, not great team.
Well, they're the Super Bowl... Well, no, they haven't really faced a not great... What was the last not great team they faced? Like, not really, like, a playoff-bound team.
The Redskins.
Arguably the Redskins.
That's probably the most arguable one.
This is a tight division right now.
Yeah,
there is no room for error by any of them.
No, and the Giants need to win the division to get in the playoffs.
Exactly, because there's no wild card coming from this division.
Watered down.
No, there could be a wild card coming from this division. It just won't be the Giants.
And, I mean, Pittsburgh coming off an awful showing going to Dallas. That's a very winnable game for Dallas. I don't know what RG3 status for Washington is this week. But
did you see that?
Yeah, it looked really bad.
And he played on it.
I heard that MRI said it wasn't. There's no torn ACL, nothing like that. It's a sprain.
It still looked disgusting.
Oh, yeah. We got rocked in the knee, and it just hyperextended. The Redskins are one game behind the Chicago Bears for the last wild card spot, who actually have the same record as the Giants, 8-5, and Seattle is 8-5.
Yeah.
The Cowboys and the Redskins have this identical records.
The 4, 5, and 6 seeds are all 8-5, so that's gonna.
If the Giants come in second place, they don't make the wild card because they won't even win the wild card because of the divisional record. Washington and Dallas both have better.
Yes, so they can't finish each other place. At the end of the season. It's gonna come down to. If the Giants lose and the Cowboys and Redskins win out, it's impossible. One of them's going to lose because they play each other on the last week of the season. So this division very well could come down to the last game of the season, Dallas in Washington.
Washington is 3-1 in the division. They have the best division record.
What's Dallas in the division?
Dallas is 3-2. So
exactly.
One game behind them, and they play each other.
Yep, at the end. So that's going to decide.
Yeah. So it's either the Giants make it and one of them makes it, or both of them make it.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say only one team from that division is gone.
I don't know, man. Beyond the...
Because Seattle's not going to lose at home.
No, Seattle's better than...
No, I think Seattle...
The second or third place team out of the NFC.
Seattle will make it. I think Chicago... I think Seattle will make it. You don't think Washington or Dallas can knock off Chicago?
I think...
Out of all those teams, I think...
You know what?
Without Urlacher...
I think Chicago's going to miss the playoffs, to be honest with you.
Then that would base that would put with the way... Unless Minnesota can overtake Washington and Dallas...
I don't see that. None of that. That's not going to happen.
That would put two NFC East teams in the playoffs.
Tampa Bay pretty much took themselves out of it this week.
St. Louis is the six, you know, the one game behind the Washingtons and Dallas. They're 6-6-1. That tie kind of helps their winning percentage.
Outside shot.
Yes. They're the dark horse, I guess.
The dark horse.
But there could be two NFC. And they could both go, you know, just 10 wins. The Giants and the... Cowboys, the
Does
Giants,
anyone
and the Redskins
want to play either of those
wins?
Two teams in the playoffs, by the way?
I think teams want to play Dallas in the playoffs.
Dallas is starting to play really well right now.
I don't know, man. They won by
the
skin of
their players
stop
getting
game.
Into car accidents.
Well, yeah, they.
It wasn't like they blew the doors off of Cincinnati.
Like Cincinnati blew the doors off the Giants?
They did.
I know. That's what I'm saying. So, therefore.
You can't play.
Dallas played
you
really
can't play
well.
They beat them and we beat them, so we're better.
You can't
play that.
I'm
no,
not saying the Cowboys are better than the Giants. I'm just saying that the Cowboys played a better game than the Giants did against Cincinnati's a good team.
Yeah, there's no arguing that.
And the Cowboys went on the road in shitty conditions and grinded out a victory a day after one of their players was killed in a car accident.
If the Giants let's say it's Giants-Dallas, and Dallas wins the division, and the Giants are the wild card, they finish with the same record Dallas, I believe Dallas.
That can't happen, though.
What do you mean?
The Giants can't be the wild card under Dallas.
Yeah, they can.
Well, it depends on what. If I'm assuming them and Washington would
if
end
Dallas
the same
gets in, then the Giants
true.
Would.
I'm a liar.
Definitely yeah. win the wild.
If they finish, okay, go.
Okay, so then let's say Green Bay holds out their division lead over Chicago. They're the 3 seed. I don't think Seattle is. I think Seattle will be in there. You could look at basically 4, 5, and 6 seeds all having the same record.
Mm-hmm.
And the 7, 8, 9 seeds that don't make it also
four,
having the
four,
same
four, five,
record.
And 6 teams being which ones? Being which teams, would you say?
4, 5, and 6 teams?
In that case, it'd be the Giants.
I think it would be Seattle, Atlanta, San Francisco, Green Bay. You know, Green Bay or San Francisco, I think, could flop in between the 2 seed. But I think that tie is going to help them because even if they finish the same amount of wins as Green Bay, they'll get the 2 seed. So, Green Bay, it'll be Seattle, and then Dallas Giants, and that would put it on pace for it. Dallas going to Seattle and the Giants going to Lambeau.
The team I don't want to play is Seattle and
on the road.
Three. I don't want to play them at all, to be honest.
Their
defense is real good, man.
Their offense is pretty good.
Their
rookie quarterback.
Pretty good too. Yeah, rookie quarterback.
He's a wild card, yo. He's such a wild card.
If you can stop Seattle's running game, I think that gives you a pretty good chance to win.
Rookie quarterback
the
who has,
can't stop the run.
Well, you said Dallas would have to go to Seattle.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, Russell Wilson has arguably better stats than Andrew Luck.
He's thrown 350 less passes.
Yeah, well, in terms of a percentage.
Yeah. Listen,
he's got way better numbers.
If Andrew Luck had a Pro Bowl running back on his team, I'm sure he wouldn't have to throw 60 passes a game.
Yeah, but Russell Wilson's not throwing to Reggie Wayne.
Yeah, there's that. Well, Sidney Rice is the best he's got.
Sidney Rice isn't too shabby.
He's not Reggie Wayne.
He's not the Sidney Rice of the Brett Favre days.
You're right, but still. That
Favre Rice.
The Colts offense relies on Andrew Luck to run. You know, the Seattle Seahawks don't rely on
They rely on Marshawn Lynch.
Exactly.
In the offense,
and that defense.
Yeah, in the offense.
Their defense is beast, and I think that I don't know, man. They force turnovers, and I think that's the worst situation for Dallas going into Seattle
and the Giants.
Yeah, both teams.
Yesterday, Tony Romo threw his first pick on the road in 4 games. All his picks are at home. He's thrown 9 interceptions of his 16 in 2 games.
Yeah, well, but you can't say that he's not prone to turn. Like he doesn't.
Oh,
have
he
turnovers.
Is, but they mostly come at home.
Yeah, and in big situations.
I think that's more of a coincidence than what's the word I'm looking for? Than a correlation.
He's quietly having a very good season.
Good. Thanks. Physics guy over here.
You good.
Astronomist.
Not to be confused with astrology, which is bullshit, because everything happens for a reason is not a fucking reason for anything.
Sure
shut up with that. Whenever, you ever know a girl who says that all the time?
Yes.
Everything happens for a reason, like when like a girl breaks up with a guy, or like a guy breaks up with a girl.
Mm-hmm.
Everything happens for a reason. It's okay. That doesn't make it okay.
No.
It could be a good reason or a bad reason.
Yeah.
And to say everything happens for that, just shut up. Stop saying that, because if I hear that again, I might punch a woman in the face.
You know what's crazy?
You should.
We were talking about Seattle, how they won. Everyone knows they won 58-0 over the Cardinals.
Yes.
It was disgusting.
It was the 4th largest win margin in a shutout in NFL history. It was
that was only the 4th best shutout.
The number one was Bears over the, the Redskins in the first NFL championship, and they won 73-0. The Bears
in the championship.
Yeah, the NFL championship.
Still,
the
Super Bowl. It's a championship. Oh, okay.
They won 73-0.
That
was one, and then Patriots were like 50-59, and there was another 59-0, and then this is 4th. I mean, Russell Wilson only had 148 yards.
He generally only has, like, maybe, if he has 200 yards.
Yeah, but the team had 58 points.
Defense. Their defense. They're,
yeah, they
Marshawn Lynch had three
they had
touchdowns.
Marshawn Lynch, and then 19 pick return, pick six, fumble for a touchdown, a Russell Wilson touchdown pass,
you know
Marshawn
what?
Lynch, and then Leon Washington
you know
on
what?
The mop-up
Giants,
duty.
The Giants might be right against the Seahawks.
You think so?
Because, I mean, their defense is real good, but
yeah.
the Giants D-line against Marshawn Lynch.
The Giants D-line is severely underperforming this year.
But they picked it up as of late, as they usually do.
But they still, and they're still prone to just get the top of their defense blown off. How many times?
True. Well,
when
hey.
You watch the Giants, do they have, you know, 25 plus yard plays thrown against
them?
Dude,
they've been throwing some, like, Stevie Brown. He's been doing real well.
Yeah, no, they get turnovers too.
Stevie Brown has 7 picks this year.
Yeah, they get clutch turnovers, the Giants. They definitely do. But a lot of times too, they get toasted. I mean, the Cincinnati
AJ
game,
Green.
AJ Green was fucking.
That
himself.
Play right there.
Yeah, he was on his own galaxy.
Yeah, that's the worst of it. That was the worst.
Even against the Saints, you know, what was his name? It's not Josh Morgan. John Morgan? Something like that?
Josh Morgan.
No, it's not Josh Morgan. It's
no, Josh
different player.
Is other guy.
Yeah. It's like John Morgan on the Saints.
J. Morgan.
He was, yes, J. Dot Morgan.
J. Dot.
He had two nice deep passes where the Giants just, you know, their secondary just looks torched. And a team that can play defense against your offense and can make those big plays. I mean, I think Seattle's. I don't think you.
Yeah, Seattle's
Seattle.
A dangerous team, but I don't think the
but
Giants.
It can also break out where Seattle ends up being the 6th seed, and the Giants end up being the 4th seed.
True.
It's everything is so close right now in the standings. It's wild. It's so wild how close.
Yo, but honestly, for as much as people have been complaining about football this year, it's shaking up to be a pretty fucking interesting end of the season. In both
in the NFC
this week, there's a lot of good games.
In the NFC, the 2 and the 3 seeds both have 9 wins. 4, 5, 6 have 8 wins. 7, 8, 9 have 7 wins.
Yeah.
So there's 9 teams that are basically
it's
going
open.
For 6 spots. Yeah. And the same thing in the AFC. The fucking Jets are a game out of the wild card.
Just stop ridiculous. Winning, Jets. Just stop it now at this point. Just fucking stop.
They're one game behind Pittsburgh and one game behind Cincinnati. They're one game out of the playoffs. For all the fucking piling and piling and piling of shit on top of the Jets this year, they're one game out of the playoffs with 3 to play.
It's like they piled a lot of that shit on themselves.
I mean, this team is not as good, and I'm not saying they're going to do what this team did, but I really hope they don't do like a 2009 type deal. And somehow, in the last game of the year, when they played the Bills, they just like they played the Chargers and the Bills after the Titans on Monday.
The Chargers just beat the
shit
out of the
and just somehow, some way, they back into the playoffs like they did in 2009. I wouldn't know how to react to that. I couldn't get excited because I've been so negative the entire year.
They have to overtake Pittsburgh and Cincinnati, though. I mean, the thing is, they have a schedule that could permit them to do that.
Yes, they do. That's the only thing, is that they can. Their schedule is very easy. The Chargers, you know, just beat the Steelers.
They're just like warm-up. They're just like a warm-up.
The Steelers
for the fucking,
have the Steelers,
next round, though.
The Steelers have to play. Hold on. The Steelers terrible. Have to play in Dallas next week, and then they play Cincy.
That could be easily 2 losses.
Yeah, okay, but regardless of the Cincinnati game, those teams play each other. So basically, no matter what, if the Jets win Week 16, they're gaining a game on one of the teams they're chasing in the wild card.
Mm-hmm.
So if they can go 2 out of 3, see, it's insane. It's insane. Now.
Imagine if
do you
Jets
really
want to
see the Jets go to the playoffs and get dick stomped in the first round.
I don't know, man. If they make it to the playoffs, I'm
you know
throwing
what?
Out all previous expectations and everything I felt about this year's season. If they make the playoffs, I'm just gonna erase it from my memory.
You should put just, $20 in the morning in the Super Bowl.
They're gonna have to play
go to
good,
Vegas on Thursday.
They're gonna have to play a good team in the playoffs. And
maybe I could just bet them to make the playoffs instead.
Either way, you should put $20 on that. That's a good bet because the odds have to be against them intensely.
Oh yeah.
And the Bengals play at Philly, which I'll say they'll win. It's a Sunday night game, but I think Thursday game. I'm sorry, Thursday game.
Oh, another.
I think they'll win in Philly,
game.
But then they play Pittsburgh. Which we said that helps the Jets regardless of who wins, and then they play Baltimore, and Baltimore might be playing for seeding, so they might still be playing.
They just fired their offensive coordinator.
I know, but they might be playing for seeding, and I can very easily see Cincinnati losing. Say if Cincinnati goes 1-3 in their last one and two. That would make them 8-8. And if the Jets win out or go 2-2, they would also be 2-1. They would be 8-8. Now I don't know who wins the tiebreaker. I wouldn't know who would have a tiebreaker.
ESPN's got to be. They're trying to flex out of Jets Titans Monday night, right?
No, it got flexed out of Sunday night.
Oh.
And then went to Monday night. It was originally supposed to be Sunday night.
How pissed are they? Look at these games. You got Giants Falcons.
Here, hold on. You know what?
And Packers Bears this week at 1.
I think conference record would be their tiebreaker. Because they didn't play each other this year.
Yeah.
And they're not in the same division, so we'll go to conference. And the Jets are 4-5. The Bengals are 5-5.
So the Bengals would get in.
As of right now. Yeah. But if they lose two out of their next three games are
conference games. Which are all AFC. Oh, no, but they're two out of three of them.
The two that I at least think they would possibly lose are conference games.
The Jets are going to lose to the Chargers, I think.
I don't know, though. They historically beat the Chargers in...
Pittsburgh lost for the very first time in team history at home against the Chargers this week.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah no, but no,
they wouldn't be surprised. For their jobs.
I would not be surprised if the Chargers beat the Jets.
When would you play harder, if you're playing for your job or if you're playing?
Frankly, I'd be surprised if the Jets win Monday.
Yeah, it's getting ahead of ourselves to talk about this situation.
You know, they have to beat the Titans, and I wouldn't be too confident about that happening.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know though. The Jets, we'll see.
I mean, last I checked, Ryan Lindley doesn't play for. You're not seeing Ryan Lindley again.
Well, they didn't see him last week.
Well, Chad
Jaguars. Chad Henne's beaten the Jets many times.
Yes.
You know what, though? I mean,
that's all you need to know about the Jets.
You know what is kind of sad about this year, though, is that in the playoff hunt, it's kind of sad to not have both Eastern Conferences, you know, like the NFCs and the AFCs, both competing. Like, seriously. Like, I feel like for the past few years, it's been a dead heat for both Eastern divisions.
The NFC East is very close.
The Jets, I mean, yeah, they could still make it in. Yes, we know this, but let's be real.
You guys remember
they're not in the heat.
You guys remember when Arizona...
If you're one game out, you're in the heat.
You remember when Arizona went into New England and beat them?
Yeah.
And were 4-0?
Yeah, okay.
What the fuck happened to that team?
That was a long time ago.
Yeah.
If we're talking about the right now, you can't say they're not in the heat if they're one game out. Not saying they're going to get it.
Let me rephrase it another way. Strictly in the division, even in the AFC East, it's usually Miami's still contending by now, or Buffalo's even threatening.
One of those two is usually Miami, contending. But they're not really, though. They're not really.
They suck now.
No, even though Miami hasn't really...
But when
they won the division...
Until the end of the year, it's close enough where they could affect it. Now, in this past couple weeks, they've pretty much dropped out.
Yeah. I mean, the division is not that good, just like the NFC East. That division is not that good. The Eagles are water trash.
Yeah, the Eagles are fucking garbage.
The Cowboys are Jekyll and Hyde, and so are the Giants. You don't have a consistent team in that division.
Nope.
Same thing with the Redskins.
Yeah, that's true. There's no consistency in that division.
Not at all. And that's why I can't say the Giants will win next week, because they can just fucking turn in a stinker and lose 35-10. Would you be surprised?
No, I wouldn't be surprised by either way with it, but I think they're going to win because the Falcons are a good team.
Or I can see them winning the next two games and then
losing to the Eagles.
Losing to the Eagles the last game of the year, and somehow that affects
them. Yeah, I can see that happening.
I could see the Browns beating the Redskins this week.
The NFC East is going to come down to the last game of the season.
I don't know about that.
I think that's what's going to happen.
I think next week one of the Cowboys or the Redskins will remove themselves from contention.
But they
by
play
losing.
Each other again.
If Robert Griffin III doesn't play
the Redskins and the Cowboys?
Redskins and Cowboys.
Last game of the season.
It's Giants, Eagles...
So yeah, I think if the Giants take care of business, that could be the wild card play-in game.
That makes that game fucking awesome.
Yeah, if the winner goes in, somehow the seeding breaks out. Chicago falls out of it. Seattle has their
Chicago's fading fast, and they got Green Bay this week.
Yeah,
Green Bay.
You never know, though, divisional games. You never know.
And then the Cowboys get the Saints at home in Week 16. So.
Imagine if Green Bay and Seattle tied for the third seed, and Seattle got it because of that fucking replacement ref game.
Where Seattle won.
Imagine that.
Just imagine.
Roger Goodell, you're a douchebag.
Yeah. Let's get rid of kickoffs.
Let's not get rid of kickoffs. That's the dumbest proposition ever made.
No, let's get rid of kickoffs. Greg Schiano, his great idea. Make it 4th and 25, or 4th and 15.
15, yeah.
And then punt it. Punting is just as dangerous as kickoff plays, except it's not more, as many guys.
It's more dangerous.
There's not as many players running down the field, you know, laying blocks, but it's still very dangerous.
No, but as far as defenseless and unknowing receivers, the guy, when you're catching a punt, your head's up like this, and there's a guy literally 5 yards from you. On a field goal, at least you got 20 yards of space to look.
Yeah. It's ridiculous. Let's take all the dangerous things out of football.
Let's just take the pads off and give them flags.
Yeah, like, what the fuck?
Like, seriously.
Stupid. Anyway.
Back on the ranch.
Back on the ranch.
Back on the range.
Eli had a good game yesterday. Two dumb picks. Two identical-looking picks, actually.
Two derps.
Where Tom Coughlin went off. Both of them, I'm pretty sure. They showed him pretty fucking angry on the sidelines because they were stupid.
At Eli.
At the whole thing. Because it was disgusting.
Yeah, but they did what they had to do and they won.
Exactly.
You know, you could argue Mark Sanchez had a good game too. I mean, he overthrew a couple open receivers. Yeah. But then again, you know, they had a drive where Bilal Powell ran the ball 7 straight times and then punched it in the end zone.
Well, Eli wasn't too, like, he didn't throw a lot. I mean, they weren't on the field that much on offense.
Yeah, they weren't chucking the ball, and they were up by a lot early. You know, it wasn't like, you know, the game got out of hand quick, I feel like, and they kind of went vanilla. But our team removes the balls from our quarterback, and your team pumps the balls of your quarterback up and lets him throw the deep ball.
Yeah.
Mark Sanchez can throw a deep ball, but the Jets never let him.
The problem is, who's
goes to the other team.
Yeah, exactly. And who's he throwing it to?
Yeah,
that's
exactly.
Deep.
You know, Stephen Hill is out with an injury now. They don't know how long, if, you know, he's going to miss time or how long it is. And they got to sign another fucking schmo off the practice squad.
Yeah.
Claude Gates is out with a concussion. It's Antonio Holmes is out. You know, this isn't 2 years ago. There's no Braylon Edwards. There's no Jericho Cotchery.
Yeah.
They're fucking boned.
What's funny? The G-men have like a blowout victory, and it was still boring. Except for David Wilson.
It was kind of boring.
It's boring
half.
To talk about it because it's like, again, like you said, like, they're consistently inconsistent.
Yeah.
Like, you can't be, you're right in saying that. You can't be surprised by either way if they win or lose. You can't,
there's no,
you've seen
like,
it all.
There's no middle ground anymore this year. It's not like last year where they were, like, winning all these games by coming from behind. This year it's either, like, they're smanging or they're getting smanged.
Yeah.
Either way. They're fucking or they're being fucked. It's not, you know, you don't see those close quarter, those close games, fourth quarter drives. You know, the Redskins game was close, 1 point, yeah. Yes. But I think more likely this season it's been, you know, one way or the other.
It's just, it's again, though, it's more interesting to talk about the Jets than
talk
about
the
Giants.
They're so fucking dramatic. It's like there's so much bullshit going on.
The Giants is always that air of, they'll be okay.
Not even that they'll be okay, it's just like, people think they know what they're doing because they win and produce Super Bowls.
They do the same thing every year.
You know,
they have a great first half.
There's like
there's
a media obsession with the Jets because everyone always says, like, the media always want, you know, like, famous people, I feel like, always like, oh, the media always wants you to fall or whatever.
Yeah.
So they're just like waiting for the Jets' Hindenburg to collapse and burn in flames.
Quick update: the Patriots show the Texans who's the top dog in the AFC right now.
Wow, I picked it the wrong way in this game.
21-0 Patriots. Aaron Hernandez 2 touchdowns. Brandon Lloyd with the other. So Tom Brady.
Wow. So, there. Congratulations to Bathroom Bandito for making it to the playoffs, too. I mean, for making it to the next round of the playoffs, because Brandon Lloyd with a touchdown.
That's all he needed?
Yep.
Wow. Congrats. No one took your fucking Skittles,
yeah,
thing.
Yeah, Mike did.
Yeah, I took your Skittles.
Mike took Bango Skittles.
He has been searching for his Skittles for the past 20 minutes.
You know, I thought he was conscious of me taking them, and he was just waiting, but I guess I was that good.
No, I saw him steaming about it. I knew you had them.
Yo, let me get some.
Pickpocket. Yeah, it smells like my butt.
Smoke another joint, bro. Smoke another joint.
All right, so I'll be honest. I didn't think the Giants were going to win like that, but I'm not surprised.
No, I thought it would be a shootout the whole way, at least.
The Jets,
I mean,
games,
I thought
I mean, what's more
lose.
Boring than a Jet game?
Or
what's more exciting than a Jet game?
Death.
Slow masturbation?
Tediously slow masturbation?
I don't know about tedious. You make it sound like it's like you don't want to do it.
Well,
tweet us at On Deck Show. Tell us what's What's more exciting than watching a Jet game?
Yeah,
watching
that's good.
Paint dry?
Lead paint, yeah.
Yeah. Watching a session of
drinking
your
mercury from a thermometer.
Watching a session of your sex.
Like me or your own?
Like you.
Like you watching me have sex.
Yes.
That's a lot of fun.
Why? What?
That's boring. You're a missionary man.
Oh. Yeah, you are.
I watch you.
Yeah, you are. I've seen
it. Well, down there, what do you know about what I'm doing?
I don't know shit. For the record.
No, I'm not.
I know everything about
it. For the record, this kid's probably an animal in the sack. I'm just kind of trying to get him going.
You can ask her. She'll tell you everything you
I mean, you know what?
Know.
You're a pretty hairy dude.
I am.
So you got some serious testosterone.
Animalistic.
You got some caveman instinct in there.
Oh, yeah.
Likewise.
Yeah. It comes out sometimes.
You're swinging the club.
Sometimes it does come out.
Swinging the club. Yeah, because I knocked them unconscious.
Thoughts. Anyway, yeah, that's good. Tweet us what's more exciting.
Jet game. I feel like what's more exciting than... I mean, giant games are kind of exciting, I guess, because, like... if you're a manic depressive, you shouldn't be a Giants fan. Because they are so up and down. Like, one week it's like, oh my God, they beat the Saints. They scored 52 points to get the Saints. And then it's like, oh, we just lost to the Redskins by 1 point because we fucking fugazied the game away on dumb plays. I'm going to hang
They always make themselves a safety net.
Brandon
Lloyd in the beginning of the season.
That's been Bandito's bench, by the way.
Oh, never mind.
Still up 122-140.
The bad dub on Twitter says, shaving his pubes is more exciting than watching the Jets. And at Bango 1628 says watching grass grow.
I've done both.
Yeah, at the same time.
I have shaved the bad dub's pubes.
Oh, and watched Bango's grass grow?
Yeah, and watched his grass grow. It was in his front lawn.
No other show in New York will our host shave your pubes.
Yeah, you know what? Maybe we should do a competition for that.
Probably
win
not.
A chance to have Garaccio shave your pubes. I'll do your butthole, too.
Whoa.
Yeah.
P double B's.
Yeah, I'll bleach. I'll bleach you in your butthole so it's not brown. Like Angelina Valentine.
She's got a cornhole.
She's got it, the grossest butthole. She's got a serious cheer. Okay, so Giants won. We went over that. We started moving to the Jets. Let's keep going with this.
Okay.
17-10 win over Jacksonville, yeah. Which the two of us thought. James and I thought it was going to be a win by Jacksonville.
I did.
No way they were losing to Jacksonville, man.
Cecil Shorts not playing, I think, helped out a lot.
Yeah, I mean, they dropped some open passes, but the defense played pretty well.
Well, I'd hope so.
You don't believe in Chad McKinney?
Not when he's not playing the fucking Texans,
yeah,
apparently.
They didn't really turn the ball over that much. I mean, they
didn't give him a chance to.
That's true.
So this morning on the highlight, I heard Mark Sanchez threw for over 100 yards. That was the highlight.
Yeah, 111. Yeah.
Mid fourth, he went over 100 yards. He had 78.
They really castrated him, huh?
Yeah. Well,
that's what I just said. They took the Jets have taken their quarterback's balls away. You know, when he was playing in 2009, 2010, he was slanging the rock, man.
Yeah, but they had a better run game.
Well, they had a better run game. They had better wide receivers. Yeah. That's my point. So, the Jets haven't provided him with the talent level that they should have. And now they're basically punishing him by it, but, you know, they took his nuts away from him. I feel like, you know, three years ago, you know, how many times do you see him booting out on a play action, right, throwing bombs to Dustin Keller? Mm. You know, he was throwing deep to Santonio Holmes. They had a nice end zone. You know, they were great in the red zone last year. Granted, that was Plaxico versus a lot of that was Plaxico.
Yeah.
But, you know, Santonio Holmes.
Factor.
Yeah.
Anytime you got a 6'9" Moulinyan,
I think he just got his balls taken away from him, and I think they need to trade Tebow and he gets one more season, and if he bombs, then the Jets.
I think his balls were taken away when they signed Tebow a little bit. I think they started clipping him then.
When
they traded for him, when they got Tebow, whatever. I think that's kind of took his balls away a little bit right there.
Yeah, but I mean, it should have given him, like, that's not enough to take. If you're Mark Sanchez and you know that you're a capable quarterback and you know your position and the skills it takes, you know Tim Tebow is not.
In the sense that you knew they didn't have that much, that they had less faith in him than was previously thought when they got Tebow.
I think that less faith in him got developed through the season. I think they got Tebow to.
I think it got worse, but I think getting Tebow alone.
I think they got Tebow as an ass backwards way to try and motivate him to take the next step because he's never been challenged at all. Mark Brunell was his backup.
Yeah, but why would you need to get a motivator if you believed in your quarterback?
Because they don't really believe in him.
No, I think they might not really believe in him, or they think that he's just not growing as fast as... Or they think that maybe he could be growing as fast if he was motivated or focused.
They were hoping Tebow was his, growth hormone.
Yeah, basically.
His testosterone
boost. Yeah, boost his nuts up. And then...
He was draining his nuts on too many hot celebrities.
48 points.
Yeah.
You know...
Yeah, I remember that. I remember that first week. Everybody was like, oh, my God!
They had a touchdown on special teams. They were getting turnovers. You know, they lost to the Steelers week two. Week three was overtime against the Dolphins. They just hit a shit patch in the middle of the season, and Mark Sanchez is playing like garbage. But, I mean, he has shown the ability to be an NFL quarterback. At least someone that you could, if you put a decent team around.
There are still quarterbacks in the league that I would not take over Sanchez.
Yeah, but I mean,
Ryan Lindley? It's about three names long.
The entire Cardinals staff.
I would take Mark Sanchez over
Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Anybody on the Cardinals?
Yes, I said that. Yeah. Tweet us at On Deck Show. At On Deck Show. Tell
who
us.
What starting NFL quarterback
would you take? Would you not
Sanchez.
Take? Would you keep Mark Sanchez for? If you could have any quarterback.
Who's worse than Mark Sanchez?
Yeah.
Put it that
Blaine
way.
Blaine Gabbert?
Blaine Gabbert's worse. I would rather have Mark Sanchez than Blaine Gabbert. Keep going down. We'll scroll down. Let's go through. I'm thinking
Blaine Gabbert, like you said, the Cardinals staff.
I still rather have Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Brady Quinn.
Or Matt Castle, yeah.
Matt Castle. I get Ryan Fitzpatrick, you could argue for, but he's a turnover machine too. He's not like he's anything great.
Yeah, he's yeah.
And he has no
He throws a lot.
Yeah,
and he's
but he has no prior success besides one pretty decent season. You know, Mark Sanchez has a better resume.
He does usually have a good beard though.
Ryan. He does. I'll give him that. And he's smart. But Sanchez has a little more on his... A little beefier resume than Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Yeah, and apparently he's a little beefier in his pants too because he fucking slays chicks.
Who?
Sanchez, yeah.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Sanchez's pussy domination is not...
That's not a question right now.
He is dominating that part of the game.
That's true.
He is.
As far as the athletics, sexual sphere
Longoria,
goes, right up there.
Jamie Lynn Siegler... Supposedly, he was banging an 18-year-old chick, too. Did you hear about that?
16?
Miss Kate Upton.
Yeah, he did smang Kate Upton before she left him for Justin Verlander.
You think
that's
he banged...
Upgrade,
100%
upgrade.
You think he banged Greg McElroy's sister?
I think he banged Nick Mangold's sister.
Well, who hasn't?
I think I banged Steve Nash's wife, and that's why our kid's black.
No, that was Jason Richardson, his teammate. That sucks.
Yeah, that's coming up. Let's talk about
we'll
that
get
a little
to bit.
Yeah.
A little bit.
So really, why go with Sanchez after the McElroy game last week?
Because they owe Sanchez $10 million next year.
Yeah, and I mean,
and they figured this was a game where Sanchez could play well. And
if you don't start Sanchez, the Jaguars game, that's it. He's done.
Yeah.
There's
no going back.
But here's my problem. They didn't even dress McElroy.
Yeah,
they wanted the extra halfback.
I think Tebow needs to go. I really think Tebow. I think there was so much negativity brought on when he came. Not that he brought it with him. I just think think it was brought unintentionally.
I'm not wrong in saying that you were against the Tebow thing from the get-go. Am I? Were you against it from the get-go?
I didn't want Tebow at all. Never. Why would I want Tim Tebow?
And that's how I feel. Is that I think it was. And I'm not a fan. I'm like just as somebody.
Skittles? What the fuck?
Just logically, I had no understanding of why they were getting Tebow.
Me neither.
Ooh. And you know what? You could say, it hasn't hurt them because they haven't put him in. But you know what? It hasn't helped them when he's been in whatever little time he has been.
I mean, he hasn't done what Brad Smith did.
No.
Brad Smith was returning kicks. Joe McKnight's a great kick returner.
It does more harm than good because he disrupts the flow of the offense.
He doesn't do anything.
I know.
The Chief wants Tebow to start.
That's all he wanted for his birthday. Was Tebow to start against Jacksonville?
You know what, though? I bet he does because he's a fucking Dolphins fan.
I'm surprised the owner of the Jaguars didn't call Woody Johnson and be like, listen, we'll get so many more fans if Tebow starts. I'll throw you, $5 million.
Right.
Just make him start this game. Yeah, or something like that. I'll throw you a couple mil.
I will personally come down and suck your dick if you give us Tim Tebow.
That'd make me start him.
Right? You know who I want to suck my dick? Jerry Jones.
Kate Upton? Jerry Jones? Not Jerry Brown, right?
No, not Kate Upton. No, not Jerry Brown. Not Kate Upton. Justin Upton.
Justin Upton.
Come to New York.
Yeah, right.
Somehow. That's a Yankee.
Yeah, right. I wish. That's right. We're going to get Ichiro.
Yeah.
Fucking 39. Huh?
You guys already signed him, right?
No.
No, they're about
aggressively pursuing. They're all over him.
Yankees big spenders this year.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Dude, the Dodgers are just stupid.
Stupid. We'll get to baseball.
Let's not talk about baseball yet.
Short. 9:41. Pat, you want to give us an update?
Yeah, let's do that.
Shortly. Yeah, sure. You want to let's.
We discussed the Jets sucking.
We said the
winning,
Patriots were up 21-0 over the Texans. Matt Schaub only has 75 yards, I believe, as of right now.
As long as he doesn't have negative points.
48 of them, Andre Johnson.
No, he's got 118 yards. Tom Brady with 159 and 3 touchdowns.
Fuck you, Tom Brady. God damn it.
Thursday night, Broncos beat the Raiders 26-13. Broncos are 10-3.
I know, they're good.
They are good.
MVP at the quarterback position.
Rams beat the Bills 15-12.
Fuck.
Cowboys win with the last second field goal, 2019.
Great win for the Cowboys yesterday.
That was. Browns beat the Chiefs 30-7 in a game that nobody cared about. Colts over the Titans 27-23. Andrew Luck comes down from 13 to win.
Yep.
Imagine if he wins in Denver in the playoffs. Vikings beat the Bears 21-14. Chargers over the Steelers 34-24. Oh. Eagles beat the Bucks 23-21 on a last second play by Nick Foles. Redskins beat the Ravens 31-28. Kirk Cousins punches the game tying touchdown to send it to overtime. And then a punt return to the 30.
How many carries did Ray Rice have yesterday?
Ray Rice, 20.
What the fuck are they doing?
121 yards and one touchdown.
Is that hopefully that's why they fired
them. Flacco threw 3 touchdowns, man.
Yeah, but still, you only.
It's been their defense. The Ravens' defense has been burning them. They have all their linebackers are hurt.
Mm-hmm.
The Panthers beat the Falcons 30-20. Jets won 17-10 over the Jaguars. Dolphins, you know, lose the Niners 27-13.
Still, though, you got to hand the ball.
Oh, yeah.
Ray Rice won 20 times.
Yeah, 30, 40, 50. If he was on the Jets, he'd carry it 60 times a game.
If he was on the Cowboys, I'd give him 80 carries. I wouldn't even throw
Giants beat the Saints 52-27. The Seahawks beat the Cardinals 58-0.
That's Packers, a good old-fashioned ass
Packers
whooping.
Beat the
you know
Lions
what I say to something like that?
27-20.
Dude.
Yeah, they got fucking boned.
That's just like, I want to see, did Pete Carroll almost feel like he's back at USC?
Yeah, right? Scoring fucking points like that.
58-0. That's like a USC versus like Cal Poly Tech. Yeah.
And
right
yesterday in the NBA, the Clippers win over the Raptors 102-83. They're 14-6, the Clippers.
He's got brave.
The Bucks beat the Nets 97-88. That game is not as close as that score says.
No way. I turned that game on in the third
quarter.
There
was 10 minutes.
There was a 40-point lead for the Bucks.
There was 10 minutes left in the third. The Nets had 33 points total with 10 left in the third.
At Prestige Sports, be patient. We'll get there soon.
The Thunder 104-93 over the Pacers.
Talking.
Knicks 112-106 over the Nuggets in a game where the team with the superstar won. Carmelo Anthony 11 points in the fourth, shutting the door on the Nuggets.
I like that reference right there. I saw it from a Knick blogger.
Yeah, Knicks down 88. Knicks were down 88-80 in that game in the fourth and still won.
No
Magic
way.
Over the Suns 98-90. The Jazz beat the Lakers 117-110. To 110. The Lakers are 9-12. How long before Mike D'Antoni gets fired?
Nick got them.
How long before he comes out and admits in the media, I should have never taken the LA job?
Oh my God.
When he says, I work.
There's a couple.
We'll get to it later. Hold on. But there's 2 games coming up for the Knicks, and there's only one that I really want to win, and it's probably not to win your thing.
I think I know where you're going with that. Right now, there's a couple games going on in the NBA. The Heat are winning over the Hawks 100-86, 2 minutes, 13 seconds left in the fourth. The Spurs are up 82-78 over the Rockets with 4:09 left in the third. Mavericks up big over the Kings, 65-43 at halftime. The Pistons lost to the Sixers 104-97, and the Warriors beat the Bobcats 104-96. And the Raptors and Trailblazers play tonight at 10, but nobody really cares.
Yeah, who the fuck cares?
The 4-17 Raptors.
Oregon versus Canada.
1-13 on the road, and the Trailblazers 8-12.
Who cares about anything in Oregon?
Nobody.
Or Canada.
Personally,
Or Mexico for that. We don't have any teams in Mexico. Is that the next
trying to.
I was gonna say, is that the next step? Is that gonna happen?
Did they play a game in Mexico?
North American
they're like
sports?
Trying to get a game in Mexico, like. like Dallas, Arizona, because they're right there.
Yeah, come sweat dick and play football.
A World Baseball Classic coming up. I'm looking forward to that.
If the United States puts together the team that they can, they should win the World Baseball Classic, hands down.
I don't know. I think the Dominican.
But, no, Venezuela, bro.
Yeah. Shout out to the fucking NARP that works at fucking Ruby Tuesdays.
The guy who fucking picked Jose Reyes first overall.
Here's what you
overall.
Need to know about him. He had the first overall draft pick in a fantasy baseball draft, and he selected Jose Reyes.
This year.
You're an idiot.
Yeah, but...
He steals bases, bro.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, so does fucking Emilio Bonifacio.
If America put together the team they could, then they'd be phenomenal.
You can't steal... That's a well put, Bat. You can't steal first. We'll get to baseball.
Yeah.
All right, so biggest surprise...
Well, hold on, quickly, a little bit on ProFootballTalk.com.
Oh!
This is a report...
The hairpiece?
The hairpiece, Florio himself.
Shout out Incarcerated Bob.
Well, we got your back, Bob.
Goon Squad, fuck
reporting
Florio.
That the Jets may bring back Braylon Edwards.
That'd be huge.
They should have never let him leave.
They shouldn't have. I mean...
Mr. T, fucking
Adam
up.
Adam Schefter reporting, that's what at least Mike Florio
Adam Schefter's pretty reliable.
I'm going to say, I just saw... Incarcerated Bob mentioned it on Twitter, which means it's probably
going to
happen.
I mean, he was waived, so he's going through waivers. So if he does make it to the Jets, they would have the opportunity to claim him.
The Jets are going to claim him.
They should. Should have never let him leave, man. If he didn't get in that stupid bar fight and try and stab someone with a butter knife at a restaurant, he'd probably still be a Jet.
All right, now, what did you just switch to? What is it about Brandon Jacobs?
Yes, Brandon Jacobs wants to file a grievance against the 49ers because he's been suspended 3 games without pay.
Because he's an idiot.
Why? What'd he do?
He's like tweeting and Instagram and shit, talking about how he hates being a 49er. Meanwhile, all last season, all you heard from him was how he couldn't wait to get off the Giants. And now...
I almost shit.
Earthquake.
I almost shit my pants just now. That was very close.
I'm not shocked.
I had Chili's tonight. Wow. Whoa. Yeah, but... He's an idiot. That's kind
of
like...
That was addition by subtraction, getting rid of him for
that's kind of like... Fucking Jordani Valdespin wearing a Miami Marlins hat and a Philadelphia Phillies hat and taking pictures of him and putting him on Twitter. Like, that's just stupid.
But see, like then you get the picture of Kevin Durant out and he's got a Bulls hat on and people want to freak out. I don't think that's a big deal.
No, but it's not a big deal, but it's still, like, come on, man.
Well,
like,
Mets and Phillies is a big deal. Thunder and Bulls, not really exactly a big rivalry. Plus, they match the shoes, so can't hate.
Well, the Marlins hat matches everything because it's got every color there is. That's pastel.
Did they trade that monstrosity in center field yet? Or is that the only thing they're keeping?
Wow, that stupid fucking
stupid
dolphin
fucking
thing?
Dolphin home run thing that Mike Stanton just rocks balls off of.
Guys, I just have a quick update on Brandon Jacobs' stats. Brandon Jacobs' stats for the season.
Leading the league in yards, isn't he?
5 carries for 7 yards.
That's impressive.
Oh, my God. He's earning every penny of that fucking contract.
Thank God the Giants. I mean, the Giants.
How did the Giants let a guy
if they had those
go?
7 yards, they might be undefeated right now.
they might have a 2-game lead in this division. No, they might be in last place.
If they didn't have David Wilson, phenom.
One game?
He's a phenom?
He's a
phenom. You ever see him do the consecutive backflip?
No,
he's
but
a
I've seen him.
Of
I've seen
life.
Him fumble against Dallas and cry.
He's a life phenom. Yeah. Yeah.
For
he's
us?
He's killing it. He
you're
is,
part of the Giants front office now, Bango?
He is
you taking
the
credit
future.
For that?
My team.
He's first round pick for us. For that. Okay, thanks for clarifying that. Mikey the Guinea from Bohemia.
Hey, yo, you know, I actually know a guy with the last name Guido.
Really? Is he Italian?
He's Italian.
Go figure.
Just had a daughter, congratulations, on Isabella Rose
Guido?
As in, like, a question, like, Isabella Rose Guido? You know? Like,
that girl's fucked when she grows up.
Yeah.
Figuratively and literally.
And literally.
Hey.
Hey. Hey. Mm. Yo, there's a stark difference between masturbating and fucking your hand. Remember
whoa,
that.
Whoa, 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 whoa. All
right, before we make the natural transition from football onto the New York Knicks tape.
Tape City.
The New York Knicks tape.
Upcoming. Prestige Sports, are you ready?
I got a question for the masses.
Give me a question.
We're gonna take a step out.
No,
right
no,
now.
No.
Oh,
no,
oh, it's
no,
coming.
No.
Because
no.
I recently
yeah,
discovered,
I like
yeah,
this.
This has to happen.
Uh-oh.
Because
the Jets are 1 game out of the playoffs.
Yeah, right. Jets are 1 game out. Go ahead.
I just want to say that. The Jets are out of the playoffs.
I was stuck in Altoid in my
Jets
asshole.
Fans like
that's
me,
that's a joke.
And those watching and listening, there is hope alive. Slim to none.
There is bad hope.
We are not
hope.
Eliminated yet.
There's bad hope.
Misplaced hope.
Why do you want that hope? Tank them all.
No, and then what? And then what? Get a 10th round draft pick? 10th, I mean 10th pick?
This is from a couple years ago. I think it's
been that's why.
I don't know. I'm stuck.
Daryl?
No.
No.
Not close. He's their all-time. Daryl Schreiber is the Mets' all-time leader in drugs.
No, Keith.
Keith, duh. Did
Shaq
eat? Not
it. No. All right. So what did you want to question our Twitter followers at On Deck Show? Remember, you can tweet us during the show, whatever you want. We'll read it.
Hit us up.
Even if it's not about what we're talking about. Or if you want to talk about something we already talked about, like what's more exciting than watching a Jet game, or what else are we talking about? What are we telling them to tweet us about?
Quarterbacks you'd rather have.
Oh, yeah, quarterbacks you'd rather have.
Oh, no, quarterbacks you'd rather not have over Mark Sanchez.
I remember at the Bad Dub on Twitter said he's better than Christian Ponder.
Debatable.
I'm going to say yes.
He's got a better resume.
Yes.
At this point, you're going with the fact that Ponder may, improve. Develop.
He may develop, or he may Sanchez.
He may Sanchez.
He may only have C cups.
Jake Locker?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I'd rather have Mark Sanchez than Jake Locker.
Yeah, I think I'd rather have Mark Sanchez than Jake Locker.
I don't know.
I think I would. I don't know.
Matt Leinhart?
The Giants, again, fun game to watch. Not as much fun to talk about because there's nothing fun about them anymore. It's just expect the unexpected. But they're 8-5, and they're currently in first NFC East. It's getting tight.
Yep. Yes. By game.
Control their own destiny.
They do.
It's tight like a female with vaginismus, which is a condition where a woman's vagina tightens up so much that you can't penetrate it. For those of you who didn't know. But anyway, while we're on sex and stuff, put on some porn right now, because I want to get to
all
porn.
All right, okay, don't put on some porn.
Why not?
Not yet.
I want you to propose...
Why is he anti-porn?
I'm not. Why do you guys... We watch it when we do our picks.
Yes. So why can't we watch it?
You're jumping the gun.
Yeah, you are. Relax, Rocco Siffredi. You'll get your fix.
My bad. All right.
Woo, daddy.
Propose this question to our followers. Add on deck show.
Add on deck show. I have a question for you.
This is nowhere.
This has nothing to do with sports.
But who fucking cares?
It is pretty much the question of the century. If you had to give up one thing for the rest of your life, you can keep one. For the rest of your life, lose one for the rest of your life.
Guys, hit us up.
For men. No, it could work for females, too.
Women, too.
Would you rather give up blowjobs for the rest of your life or cheese for the rest of your life? Mm. Now, send us a tweet at On Deck Show.
#blowjobs or #cheese.
No, just tell us what you're with. I'm with cheese or I'm with BJ's.
Yeah, now recently, we've been discussing this for a while now.
Quite some time.
This has been like, I feel like a year and a half, maybe even 2 years going. It's been a long, long-standing debate. And I recently found a website.
Okay.
Cheeseorbj.com.
What? They stole it. We should have patented it.
I don't know if they stole it. They may have had it first, because I had to hear that from somewhere. I don't even know if I thought of that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I heard it from you, so.
Either way, check it out, because it's awesome. Wow. And there's apparently like sweatshirts and shit you can buy that say I choose cheese or I choose BJ's. Now,
Bango, you can't just tweet it's blowjobs. What are you with? What are you giving up?
Which one are you keeping?
You're keeping blowjobs?
Or you're giving up blowjobs. No, he's giving.
He's keeping cheese.
Mike Colombano.
No, he's keeping cheese. No Italians will give up cheese.
No. I'm keeping cheese all day.
And I'm keeping cheese. Bango's keeping cheese. Producer DJ White Hot, what are you keeping, cheese or blowjobs?
Blowjobs. Yeah. Oh, I only know two people in the whole world that are keeping, not keeping cheese.
I feel
cheese.
Like, at least for me, the level in which I eat cheese...
He's a bold-faced liar.
Supremely eclipses the level into which
I get
blowjobs.
It's all about the ratio of, you know, cheese, times you eat cheese in a day, to blowjobs you get in a day.
I eat cheese all the time.
The only people who realistically won't choose cheese are people who undervalue cheese or people who are lactose intolerant.
Yeah, I feel like the only way you're either you're a sexual deviant Yeah. You just get blown 24/7, or you're lactose intolerant.
Right, like,
that's like the two extremes.
Unless you're one of those people who's like, eh, cheese isn't for me. Then you don't even count for this question.
Cheese not, like, it's like someone saying, oh, I don't like bacon.
You live in America and you don't... That's, don't even get me started on the people who don't like bacon. That's like not even... If you don't like bacon, you're just...
At Uriff McHugh says, hashtag, yeah. I'm keeping cheese.
There you go.
So...
And happy birthday to him as well. Did we give him that?
No, wrong Q.
Wrong Q.
Oh, right, I don't know.
That's a wrong black guy.
Sorry,
name.
Black guy named Q.
With Q in his name.
Q in his name. I'm sorry.
No, you see,
I'm sorry,
you see, Eurythmic Q, his name is literally Q, like, spelled out.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
That's awesome.
And then the birthday today was the man Quentin.
Quentin. Happy birthday, Quentin.
And I just call him Q. Like,
Quentin's a great man.
So part my fault for my racist, you know, assumptions.
That's right. I'm educating you about African-American culture, you know? I'm a student of the game.
That's culture with a Q, right? African-American
okay, with a back culture. Okay.
All right, anyway. Yes, I'm keeping cheese. Let us know what you think at On Deck Show. Cheese or blowjobs, which one are you keeping? Which one are you giving up? We have a 4-1 vote for keeping cheese in the studio right now.
In the studio, 4-1. In White Hot Media Studio.
See, that's
media,
how I look at it as a no-brainer. Initially, you're like, I'm dumb. I'm going to keep blowjobs, bro. And then, like, when you think about it, you're like,
yeah, but
I eat so much cheese.
It's STFs, right?
Yes.
You know what, though?
An STF.
You can still get a pre-J.
An STF, for those who don't know, is a start to finish. You know, in which your partner begins the cunnilingus and finishes it then.
The
fellatio.
The
fellatio.
There's no...
No.
Yeah, exactly. You cannot... You cannot...
Right? I just go right to sex.
Your fluids through that.
No.
But it can you can prime the engine before you go in for the...
Yeah, but you know what?
Even you can't cold start, you're pulling hammy.
Honestly, if the question stood with, even if it was just, you can still get the warm-up beach, the foreplay beach, I'm still giving up the foreplay beach for cheese.
Oh, yeah.
I'll go right into the sex.
I eat entirely too much cheese.
I will spit on my own dick and go in raw.
Yeah, I mean, I just think about all the things you couldn't have... When you give up cheese, you can only not have blowjobs.
Mm-hmm. But when you can still have sex. You can still get an old fashioned.
Yeah, well, you can get an old fashioned, even though that's like 1997 type stuff. But anyway,
88.
When you give up cheese, think about all the stuff you lose.
You lose so
everything,
much cheese,
so
man.
Much food,
grilled
desserts,
cheese,
desserts,
no bacon, egg,
lunches,
cheese,
pizza,
dinner, every meal of the day. Can you can eat cheese?
Chicken cutlet parmesan.
Day.
My ideal breakfast is a bacon, egg, and cheese. My ideal lunch involves a sandwich with cheese on it.
Nobody wants just bacon.
My
and
ideal
eggs.
Dinner is pasta fazool with
baby.
Some parmesan cheese on it. Okay, you know what I love
dessert
for dessert?
Is a cheesecake.
Cheesecake.
Fucking cheese.
You know what I like for a snack? Cheez-Its.
What's the main ingredient in cheesecake?
Cheese sticks.
So if you
mozzarella cheese.
If you had to graph out a month of your life.
Everything with cheese.
A month of your life. How would you graph it out in terms of what's the ratio of amount of blowjob STFs you get to the amount of cheese your body?
Well,
intake?
You know me, I don't get STFs.
Yeah.
Unless they're accidental, like, oh,
so
honey,
it?
I'm sorry.
0.5.
You need to wait 15
so
minutes
let's
now.
Say you get 0.5 STFs a month.
Say I get 0.5, then it's a ratio of, it's like easy 80. Easy 80 to 1, then.
You gotta keep cheese.
Like,
guys.
Oh, man.
Dude, I'm eating cheese at least twice a day. And that's
minimum.
A light day. That's a light day.
What?
Yeah, you may just have a grilled cheese today.
Of course,
you
and that's just bread and cheese.
You know
cheese.
Why? Because grilled cheese is delicious. And then you jerked off, and you were like, you know what?
That cheese was so satisfying.
That cheese was fantastic. And I.
Okay.
This man is sexually aroused by cheese.
Yeah.
So he's taking cheese literally in lieu of blowjobs. Like, just give me cheese, it'll be fine.
He'll fuck a triangle of Swiss.
And don't get me wrong. If somebody came out to me and was like, listen, I can give you cheese or I can give you a blowjob right now, I'd think about it for a second.
No, you wouldn't.
But I'd always take the blowjob.
Oh, yeah.
If somebody came up and asked me, you know, if that was a regular occurrence, they were like, yo, like some smoking hot chick, some okay-looking chick. My girlfriend. Let's go with that so that I don't put myself into a precarious situation.
You just did.
I did.
You kind of just did.
If my girlfriend, I totally.
How much cheese is too much?
Okay, looking chick. Let's use my girlfriend. That's basically.
I didn't mean that. No. That's not what I meant at all. I wasn't going down
that's
the grade.
That's what
grade.
You just said.
That's not what I meant. No, I meant like instead of saying another whatever. Anyway, I'm gonna just stop.
Just
make
yeah, that's it.
If somebody offered me cheese or a blowjob right now, I'd take the blowjob. But when's that gonna happen?
Never.
When are you giving that on the spot? But this is for life. That's
life.
One time occurrence. This is for life.
That's like 20 more years.
Right? You can't eat cottage cheese when you lose your dent, when you lose your teeth.
You can't
eat cottage cheese anymore.
I don't either, but I will when I lose my teeth.
You don't eat cottage cheese, bro?
No, man.
I do.
Anyway, I had to sound off on that. All
right, so yeah, Mike, we just really wanted to bring up this point.
It had to happen.
Stir a great American debate in this country.
The greatest American debate. Yeah. Fuck Medicaid. I mean, cheese or blowjobs?
Should I X out of the...
Arsenio Hall knows how good cheese is, according to @EurythmicQ. Indeed he does, bro.
Why ain't you telling me how good this cheese was?
I bet you he's at a wine and cheese party right now.
What do you think Arsenio's doing? Bet she's at a wine and cheese party. Speaking of Arsenio Hall... The Knicks.
Yes. All right, now we can finally talk about Knicks.
How does Arsenio Hall play into that?
I don't know. Because he reminds me of basketball.
Does he?
Yeah.
And why is that?
Because he's urban. That's what corporate people... That's their name for black people. They say
urban. Because he's a real class act.
That's what they say. You know, he's a class act.
Because he's urban, he says.
They've played three games since we've been here, right? What do you...
He's throwing on the Iman Shumpert click freestyle, which, if you haven't heard it...
Iman Shumpert going in over the click beat. Don't tell me to
It's better than any Mets song ever
like
made.
Fugaze through the microphone.
Who cares? I'm vibing.
We do, because people are listening to us.
Mixtape. I'm not playing the whole damn song. Relax.
The Heat game. Let's start there, because they've played three games since we've...
Because they won by 20 points without Melo.
Without Melo, they won by 20. They were close. They were down... down after one, down going into the half, and they were down going into the fourth.
And they won by 20 points without Melo.
They made it rain threes in the third. That's basically what happened.
It was raining threes.
112 points, beat the Heat without Melo.
And then you saw what really happens when you don't have Carmelo Anthony in the Bulls game.
Yeah.
They needed Melo so bad in that game. They needed his instant offense so bad. They couldn't get anything going.
And still, they almost won.
They did.
Because their defense keeps them in every game they play, which is different than last year.
Yes.
Last year, their defense was not... Yeah, but last year, you can rely on the Knicks' defense to give that performance night in and night out, where you know no matter who they play, they're going to be in the game in the fourth unless something crazy happens.
Here's what I know so far. In a seven-game series versus any team in the East, I have confidence the Knicks will win.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think I can agree with you. I mean...
With Melo. And let's not forget they're going to get Shumpert and Stoudemire back.
And can be healthy
and
at some point.
Eventually.
I mean, we can't really... We don't know what really he's going to bring.
So it's
but
not getting worse.
They didn't even have Rashid the other night.
Well, that was in the win against Denver. He got hurt in the Chicago game. But the Chicago game, you saw when they played... That's the best defense they've played all year, the Knicks. That's the best defense they played against.
You know what? I mean, the Knicks were just missing shots, though, it looked like.
Regardless of J.R. Smith's buzzer beater in Charlotte, he hasn't been able to get a shot to fall.
Here we go, though.
They had a rough time shooting against the Bulls.
The Knicks...
They had a real rough time.
That was as disgusting a win as you can get against Charlotte. I mean, that was a bad game they played.
It's Charlotte.
Melo going 1-for-10 in the second half is what killed them.
It's the Bobcats. You
but
should
they
be
won.
Them. Yeah,
they won.
Exactly.
Regardless, they won the game. That's all.
15-5, and as Iman Shumpert tweeted out 3 days ago, I wouldn't forget to congratulate them. Miami, you have been taped.
Yes, Miami got taped
again.
We beat Miami
again.
We beat Miami. They got taped 20-20 again
in Miami.
But then they lost to the Bulls on the road.
It's all right. Can't win every game, bro.
And they came back Sunday against the Nuggets. In a tough game, Melo's first game back. It was a very tough game. It wasn't, the Nuggets aren't a team they can roll over on.
No, Nuggets are a solid
and the Nuggets
ball
were
club.
Up 8 in the fourth. Novak comes in, hits those two threes. Jason Kidd, who's been amazing.
Jason Kidd came back and
he made
an impact.
The most
again.
Important Nick right
he's
now.
He's made out of all the free agents and players they brought in going into this season, he's made the most impact.
Absolutely.
Like, there are times he goes for three where you just know he's hitting it. Like
he's
just
cashing
he
them,
just
and
just
he
know he's gonna hit.
He stays deking people and getting foul shots.
Yeah,
he
has active hands, and the rest
active
of the team
hands.
Follows suit. And how many times? I've never seen the Knicks generate as many on the ball steals when players are driving and kicking out ever. Yeah. I mean, when they're driving, when other teams are driving to the basket, Jason Kidd and the Knicks team as a whole are taking the ball away from them. And the Knicks have the best point differential in the Eastern Conference. They have, their offense is the second most efficient in the league.
They're second to what, OKC in the Western Conference, right?
They're the best team in the Eastern Conference right now.
OKC and San Antonio have better point differential.
Oh, okay.
But their defense is legit, and that's why they're in every game, no matter how poor they shoot. And when you have Carmelo Anthony, who came in the fourth with about 8 minutes left, and shut the door on Denver, he scored 11 points.
Yeah.
And he put the game out. Like we saw on Twitter the other day, I forget which Knicks blog it was from, but you know, it was someone was quoted as saying the team with the superstar won, which is true.
I enjoy the Knicks bloggers a lot more than the beat writers.
Would you want Gallinari, Mozgov, never losing Felton, and Wilson Chandler back right now?
No.
I mean, for what we got?
Melo's an MVP candidate right now.
I mean, that team got gutted. Going into that
Boston... As far as Melo is MVP.
Yeah, going into that...
Yeah, but what have you given up? Wilson Chandler hasn't played since they traded him because he's hurt.
But their whole team got gutted and wasn't built around
Carmelo Anthony. You got Felton back and Felton
when they played the Celtics in the playoffs and going into that season.
Felton's a better player.
Now the team is finally built around Melo. I think the coach is the perfect type of coach for Melo because he's a defensive-minded coach.
Melo's playing a lot of D.
And I think that he's with the perfect mix
Melo's
of players.
Melo's D is huge.
He's with the perfect mix of players in that he's with Tyson Chandler,
you know, his dick.
The leader, the championship-caliber leader, vocal-type intensity guy, and he's with Jason Kidd, the veteran-type, savvy, court guy, and I think it's the perfect mix. And George Karl said it the other day. He said that he thinks before Melo's career is over, he's going to win a championship.
He's a different
player.
And
this is
right
one
now.
Of the best teams he's played on, regardless of team, Nuggets or Knicks.
Didn't Magic Johnson just say this week the Knicks are a serious contender for the championship?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Well, I mean, they're a product of the Eastern Conference. There's nobody. Who's their biggest threat in the Eastern Conference? I mean,
Miami, whom they've stomped.
When you get to the playoffs, it's crapshoot. You know, maybe not as much as other leagues like the NBA. There's the haves and the have-nots.
It's still a series you're playing.
Yes. But, I mean, the 7 or 8 seed, the 1 seed is not out of the question. Right now, if the playoffs ended today, I mean, the season ended today, which is ridiculous since we're not even, one-third of the way through.
Absolutely.
The Knicks would play Milwaukee in the first round.
Oh, daddy. I'd like to
four games at the Garden, as I don't even think it would go that far. But that's the thing. They protect home court. Nobody wins at the Garden anymore.
19-1 at home since Mike Woodson took over.
Unbelievable.
Four games at the Garden, we wouldn't go that far? How does that work?
Because 1 and 2 would be at the Garden, 3 and 4 would be in Milwaukee.
Yeah, that series doesn't come back.
I get what you're saying.
I don't think it would go that far.
Because you said four games to go. I got confused. Not bad.
The Knicks are deep.
Now, that could change. That could be any number of teams. But by performing well in the regular season, which they haven't done in years, you get a better opportunity to advance in the playoffs by playing a 7 or 8 seed. The Knicks could win the number one seed. It's not like Miami's been the one seed the past 3 years.
They haven't been.
They were the number two seed last year. Chicago was the one seed. The Knicks could take the one seed, which would be amazing. The 2 seed would be amazing.
Yeah.
I would take the 3 or 4 seed because it's home playoff games.
Like
obviously, that's an underachievement if they do.
Yeah, but doesn't matter. They're still playing at home.
Being on the home side of the playoffs. But the higher you are, the later you get home games. And if the Knicks are playing home games in the Eastern Conference Finals, that's rough, man. That's a hard team to beat.
The Garden is a very tough place. It's becoming one of the harder places to play in the league.
Well, in Miami,
right,
they were, Melo was getting, Melo and the Knicks were getting chance at the end of the game.
They were getting chance at the beginning of the game.
In Chicago, there's a large Knicks contingent of players. And at the Garden, there is never anyone besides Knicks fans. There may be a handful of players that are fans of the other team, but you don't hear them at the Garden.
No, because they get punched in the face.
Not even that. They just... It's too loud, and there's too many Knicks fans there.
Atmosphere has helped the Knicks to be undefeated at home this year. They are the best team at home.
Yeah, well, I mean, look at a player like Steve Novak. I think at the Garden, Steve Novak is lethal. I think on the road, teams can take him out of games.
Yeah.
And I think mentally...
It all depends on if he can get his shots up.
No, I know, but I think at the Garden, he's more confident in his shots.
Could you imagine J.R. Smith started hitting shots on a consistent basis like he was?
He's going to come around. He's going to shoot himself out
of it. He's the most frustrating player and the most exciting player in the league.
Yeah, because I'm telling you, he's going to have these games where he's shooting, 5 for 19 or worse or a little better, and then he's going to break out and he's going to have a 30-point game, 35-point game. It's going to happen. He comes in waves. You just got to hope that he peaks when, you know, they need him to, and that he's not shooting 5 of 19 in the first or second round of the playoffs.
You know what, though? I feel like Mike Woodson's the perfect coach for him. Like you said, he's the perfect coach for Melo. I think he's a very good coach for JR as well.
Yeah, I think he's a very good coach for the team in general.
I got.
I didn't see.
You know, he's a very good coach for the entire team. I think it's the perfect mix of chemistry, and, you know,
they're deep.
They're deep. They're very deep. They're very deep.
I got a text from one of my favorite fat kids, RJ. No, anything Parmesan. It can't be argued with. This is back to the cheese and blowjob.
Preach, sorry. RJ. Preach.
Absolutely. No, anything Parmesan. Get out of here. Sorry. Go on.
You lost my train of thought there. I thought cheese and I got
deep. Hungry. The Knicks are deep.
The Knicks are deep. Yeah, that's what we're talking about. The Knicks are deep.
Talented.
They have good. They have a good mix of veteran leadership and players who have been there. Jason Kidd and Tyson Chandler have won an NBA title together against the Miami Heat, and that's the team the Knicks are going to have to beat to make it to the finals. And if the, you know, I don't like you said, I don't see any team in the East as in a seven-game series that I would be afraid of. Not going to say they're gonna dominate every team, but fear going into
personally.
Any series.
I don't think the Heat don't match up well with the Knicks.
I don't. I said
because the Knicks have.
I think that's
I
evident.
Said last, what did I say last week? The Knicks are built
to beat the Heat. They're taking a page out of Dallas's playbook.
They beat the Heat without Melo by 20 points. That's the fourth time I said it, and it's still awesome.
Experienced. And Tyson Chandler has the highest field goal percentage in the NBA.
Yeah, because every shot is
2 feet from the rim.
Whatever.
That's what's supposed to
happen. And most of his points are offensive putbacks.
Offensive putbacks. He's good. He's great from the free throw line.
Which means he's playing defense and correct from the
free throw line.
No, he's good career-wise, but this year he's having a great year from the free throw line.
Dead air.
Yeah, I enjoy watching this team. There's nothing more to say. And fuck Brooklyn. Us on Facebook.
Yeah. By the way, like us on Facebook. Tweet us at On Deck Show with your thoughts on the Knicks. And also like us on Facebook because we have a Facebook page now because we're getting with the times. It's brand new, you know, like Facebook is.
Facebook.com/OnDeckLive.
Holla.
We post crazy shit on there, too.
Send us dick pics on Facebook.
Okay. So the Knicks are 15-5.
Yes.
They got two games this week. They play the Nets tomorrow.
He's just such a prude, this guy. He's a prude. This Jew right here. Tanaka, what are you doing here? You shouldn't be here. You should be with your family.
A couple of them.
They go to Brooklyn tomorrow, and they are home against the Lakers on Friday or Thursday? Thursday,
they
I believe.
Play the Lakers the day I leave for Las Vegas. Okay. Let's go.
Here we go. I don't care about tomorrow.
It's a divisional game.
Even if the Nets win, who gives a fuck?
Yeah, but it's a divisional game.
I want to stomp the living shit out of Mike D'Antoni and the L.A. Lakers.
In L.A.?
That's home.
Oh, it is home. It's the Garden.
They play in L.A. on Christmas.
On Christmas. That's where I got a few.
They're going to ruin Mike D'Antoni's Christmas.
They are. I mean, the Lakers are not playing well lately.
The Lakers are trash.
The Nets are coming off four losses in a row. I think the Knicks win that tomorrow anyway.
I think they do win that tomorrow. Because Jason Kidd's healthy.
The Knicks... Net fans, your team is decent.
Yes.
They're good.
The Knicks
are a good team.
They're better than decent. They're good.
They're a 6 seed. 5 seed? Depends if...
Well, the Eastern Conference is not that strong.
I know,
can be a 4
but I'm saying, you know, is Boston going to suck like this all year? Probably.
Here, I have a question for you. I want you to tell me what you think the Lakers' record is in games in which Kobe scores over 30 points. He's done it 10 times.
They don't have. They're 0-10.
0-10?
Yeah.
This year?
I mean, 10 games he scored over 30. What do you think their record is?
1-9, maybe.
1-9.
Yeah.
Wow.
1-9 when Kobe scores over 30.
Yeah, because of your question, I figured it was on the bad side.
But this is if Pau Gasol and Steve Nash are not playing, this is a Knicks team that's going to dominate the Lakers, I feel like. Because Tyson Chandler is going to...
I think they could dominate the Lakers with Pau Gasol and Steve Nash playing.
I do as well. It would be harder, but Tyson Chandler can basically take Dwight Howard out of the game.
He's done it before.
And, I mean, who's going to guard Kobe? Probably Felton.
This is tight.
You know what? Let Kobe score 40, because the other team, his teammates probably can't score 40 by themselves.
Yep. On my mind. They can't score 40 combined.
Let Kobe score 50. You know how many points the Lakers are going to have? 80, and the Knicks will win. Just don't let – go ahead. Don't let anyone else beat you. Give Kobe all the shots he wants. He's not the same Kobe anymore either.
I mean, the Bulls game – The Bulls kind of exposed the Knicks a little bit. I mean, even though they were without Melo, they took the 3-point shot away from the Knicks. If you watch that game, man, they were pressing the Knicks.
I just think that Lehman Felton missed a lot of close shots.
Dude, they couldn't shoot from anywhere against the Bulls.
They just shot it bad.
Even when they had open shots, they couldn't hit them.
Yeah, I mean, you do have those games where you just can't.
They got blown out. It was a very close game.
Well, the ending,
and the Bulls are a good team.
The final score isn't
indicative of how close the game was.
Actually close it was in the fourth.
The Bulls
but it was it had the same ebb and flow as the Nuggets game, but in the Nuggets game, the Madison Square Garden crowd was enough to put them over the top to get them to win. It had the same ebb and flow. It was close, but the Knicks were down, and the fourth, the Nuggets went on a little run and were up 8, and it was basically the breaking point of the game where the Knicks could respond, or, you know, they could let the Nuggets go on another run and put the game away, which is what the Bulls did.
Watching that Knicks-Bulls game, and this is something I feel like I've said a lot so far this year, I felt like I was in the 90s. That was an old-school, physical, defensive game.
There was a point where I thought
that was a 1995 Eastern Conference fucking game.
Yeah. There was a point where I thought neither team was going to get 90 points.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And you can't say what you want about the Bulls. The Bulls are probably the best defensive team in the league.
Yeah.
Their team is built on defense. Thibodeau preaches defense.
That shows in the fact
especially without Derrick Rose, they know it.
They held the Knicks, who score 100 points a game, to 85.
The only chance...
Because they took away the three.
Yeah. The only chance Chicago has at winning games is holding teams under 80, 190, or even under 80.
Yeah. I'm 90. I'll give you 90.
But again, they took the three away, but it's not like the Knicks take bad threes.
No, they don't, but they didn't let the Knicks take any good threes.
Exactly.
And, I mean, that could be, you know, the main part of the potion that teams use to try and beat the Knicks.
More importantly, whose jersey is Spike Lee going to wear tomorrow?
I don't fucking care.
Shump.
Who the fuck Spike Lee
is? Big on Twitter. He's going to unveil it.
I don't give a fuck, man. The Knicks are 15-5, and now Spike Lee's coming out. Oh, what jersey should I wear? Shut the fuck up. You should have been there the fucking first week of the season. Where the fuck were you?
Filming a movie.
I don't fucking care about his movie. It probably sucks.
It probably does.
Last time he made a good movie was fucking, like, in the 90s,
bro. Do the right thing.
No, he makes urban hits, bro. No.
He makes movies for black people.
Urban hits.
Yeah, you're right. I don't care. I'm just saying.
I don't care who he fucking wears.
Novak.
Just show up.
My money's
on
Novak.
Don't show up 20 games into the season.
The Knicks, between this show and the next show we have, the Knicks play 3 games.
Yeah.
At Brooklyn, the Lakers, and Cleveland.
Yep. Home for Cleveland?
No, yeah, home for the Lakers and Cleveland.
Yep.
They could easily go 3-0. They should be at least 2-1. 2-1 is...
And that's what we said. What we said coming into this week, was that in the Heat, Bulls, Nuggets, they should go 2-1, but they could go 3-0. And if every week we're looking at 4 game clips, and we're saying
above
they
500.
Should go 3-1, or, you know, 3-2, or 2-2, or 500 or above. I mean, with the way they play at the Garden, you know.
So we're looking at the Knicks being 17-6.
Conservatively.
Yeah. You know, like I said, it's hard to get excited, but, you know. Because they've broken our heart so many times in the past.
Why wouldn't you be excited, though? You know what? Who cares?
But once they get to 20, and if they're still single-digit losses, I mean...
Live it up, enjoy it.
Then it's starting to get...
And if they're going to break our hearts, then we might as well enjoy it while it's here.
You're right. That's exactly right.
I'm not going to sit around and be miserable waiting for the Knicks to fuck up. I'm going to enjoy it, and if and when they do fuck up...
You just summed up being a Mets fan.
Well, that's pretty much what being a
if they're
going
to break our hearts... The difference is that we know that they're going to break our hearts. Like, it doesn't...
Yeah, I don't know.
It's unexpected.
Like, watching this Knicks team right now, if you were to tell me you know what? They're going to win the championship this year. I wouldn't be shocked. I'm not saying they're going to, and I'm not saying they're even going to win a playoff series, but this is a team that I think can compete with anybody in the Eastern Conference.
Yeah, not, and that's, it's
my only worry,
partially a reflection of the Eastern Conference.
Oh, absolutely. I think against the Western Conference teams, you saw what happened to them against Memphis. I'd like to see what how they stack up against OKC.
They played them this month?
We saw them play the Spurs.
They played oh, wow. OKC is number one in NBA's rankings and number two in the ESPN rankings.
You know who I... It's, you know, the only two teams I really think the Knicks will have trouble beating is the Clippers and the...
Grizzlies?
Thunder.
You don't think the Grizzlies will give them trouble?
They could, but I don't think the Grizzlies will get to the championship.
They don't have that sustain. Yeah, okay.
You know what I'm saying?
I don't think the Clippers will either.
But I'm saying I think the Western Conference Finals could very well be OKC Clippers. And I think the Knicks might have a tough time beating both of those teams.
I'm sorry, they don't play the Thunder this month.
They're going to play them eventually.
Brooklyn, at Brooklyn, and then they're home for L.A., Cleveland, Houston, Brooklyn, Chicago, Minnesota. They're home from basically now because tomorrow is in Brooklyn. That's a home game. They don't have to travel.
They're in New York
from
what, 2 weeks?
From December 11th to Christmas Day when they play at L.A., then at Phoenix, at Sacramento to end the month. They play New Year's Day versus Portland, and then when we get into January, you know.
Wait, who's after Chicago? It goes Cleveland, Houston, Brooklyn, Minnesota, Chicago, L.A.
Chicago, Minnesota.
Okay,
L.A., Phoenix, Sacramento, and that's the month of December.
We got the Nets twice in 10 days.
Yep, home and you know.
Not even in 8 days. That's nice. Yeah. 9 days, whatever.
So let's say they split with the Nets for shits and gigs, 1-1. Lakers, Cleveland, Houston. I say they go 2-1 in that time frame. That's
2-2. Let's call it 2-2. Give them the loss to Brooklyn early.
Okay, so so they're 2-2. Then here they're 3-2. Chicago, Minnesota, they split. So that's 4-3. And then they win 2 out of 3, Phoenix, Sacramento, L.A. That's 6-4 on the month.
Which is never bad to be above 500.
Oh, that's December. But think about this. They're undefeated at home, and they have six home games and the Brooklyn game in Brooklyn. So 7 home games out of 10 games for the rest of the month.
Yeah, and Brooklyn doesn't have it easy coming up. Well, they have it easier than the Knicks coming up, actually. They have the Knicks.
They've had it easier the entire season.
And they have Toronto coming up.
Here you go.
Detroit and Chicago.
The Knicks will beat the Nets
tomorrow.
They
should win, too.
The Knicks will beat Cleveland. The Knicks will beat Houston. The Knicks will beat Minnesota. The Knicks will beat Phoenix. The Knicks will
beat... You don't think they'll beat Chicago at MSG?
Oh, hold on. The Knicks will beat Sacramento. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's 6 wins right there.
So that'll keep them at the 6-4.
And that's... I didn't even look at these games. So that leaves you with 1, 2... That leaves you with 4 games against L.A., Chicago, Brooklyn, and L.A. again. Even if they split those...
8-2.
8-2.
That's impressive by any team.
It's a big month. They can put a lot of distance with all these home games.
That's 25-8.
That's fucking awesome. That's fucking winning more than 3/4 of your games.
That's incredible. They're on a 60-win pace right now. Do I think they'll win 60? I don't know. Probably not.
The Knicks
not.
Are doing pretty good.
55 games. I think they can win 55. Easy.
The Knicks are doing pretty good. Yeah, you're right. That's
the
crazy.
Are doing, they're doing
they
pretty
have,
good.
They
I
have
mean,
a team.
You
and, you know, when the Knicks are good, it's great for fucking New York, man.
Concerned about the Heat?
About their act? No.
You think they'll figure it out, or you think they're just not as good as people think they are?
I think it's both.
I think they're that good, but I think the Knicks
are
better.
I think they'll figure it out.
Is Wade hurt, or is he just not as that good anymore?
A little bit of both.
That's what I think.
I think they'll figure it out, but when they figure it out, they'll still be playing very well, but not as well as, you know, people thought they were going to be a dominant second.
I don't think, they got Ray Allen and Rashard Lewis. Watch out. Those two guys suck.
Say that statement about Dwayne Wade again. That's because there's a lot of thought that can go into that. Is he hurt, or is he just not as good anymore?
I agree with
Pat. Those two things
could
play off each other a whole lot.
That's what I said. I think he's both.
He's not 100%
healthy. He's not 100%, and a not 100% Dwayne Wade is not something
Yeah,
you can rely
and
on.
Also the assumption that he can do what he used to do is only going to hurt him more in the future, too. You know what I mean? Like, there's so much. That could be taken as a much deeper statement than just at the surface there. Like, he's hurt and he's not as good anymore. And both of them are because of the other one. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well,
he's hurt because he's not as good, and he's not as good as he's hurt. Like, it's,
you know, he's only been in the league what?
Is it time for Dwayne Wade being basically the man over?
Oh yeah. Oh, that was over last year, and he even admitted it. That's LeBron's team now.
True.
In order for them to win the title like they did last year, he needed to take it back.
Right now, the Spurs and the Rockets heading into overtime, tied at 120.
Jeremy Lin is killing
it. Jeremy Lin with 34-7. So there you go. There's the first Jeremy Lin game for Houston.
I don't know who Jeremy Lin is. Do you mean Jeremy Rin?
I'm glad to hear that everyone who killed the Knicks for letting Jeremy Lin go and everyone that said they were jumping ship to go be a Brooklyn fan, because how could the Knicks not bring back Jeremy Lin?
Yes, but the only thing about this game is James Harden has not played.
Oh,
he's
really?
Out. Yes.
Not at all.
So again,
okay.
Lin and Harden have yet to show that they can play together successfully on the court at the same time.
Miami 9-point win in Atlanta.
Yes, Miami. You want me to give you an update?
Yeah, let's go with an update.
You know what? Let's talk about the Knicks for 4 more minutes. We'll get an update at 10:30, and we'll talk baseball for a little bit.
Okay. You know I can't wait for talking.
I know I can't wait either.
I need baseball.
So bottom line, I see the Knicks as a 2 seed.
When they're all top 3 in the East, I think.
When the smoke clears, I think they're probably a 2, possibly a 3, with a slim chance of being a 1. I'm not going to count on that.
I don't know if it's that slim.
It's not. You know what?
You know, we were just
a slim yet.
You
know
what?
Not
as good as they were last
slim
year.
Slim yet legitimate.
It's
you know, it's.
It all depends on how. If LeBron James just says, "Fuck it, I'm going ham."
And there's a lot of time where, I mean, they can. By the end, January 1st, we could be singing a whole different tune with these 7 home games, man. We could be saying they're, you know, they could be substantial lead in their division.
Oh, yeah.
If they
but
take
also,
their opponents at home.
I'm going to hold off until I see them play a couple weeks with Amari.
Yeah.
Well,
I want to see how that
supposedly
gels.
Supposedly Christmas Day is the target.
He better come off
that. And,
damn
and
bench.
If I wake up on Christmas Day
and Amari's in
and
the lineup.
I get a few drinks in me at the family party.
Oh,
so much
and
wine.
I turn on that Knick game. I don't drink wine.
You don't drink wine on Christmas?
I drink
liquor. There's just hard liquor at my house.
I mean,
hard liquor.
Hard.
Hard. Which is what I will be if the Knicks win and Amari plays well
off the
bench
on
Christmas.
And they win. If Amari plays, that'll be a wonderful Christmas gift to me. Just if he plays and he's on the court and he makes it through his however many minutes he plays, he makes it through and doesn't.
I saw him working out before
body.
The game the other day. He looks like he's in phenomenal shape.
Wasn't he in the best shape last year though?
No, he put on. Supposedly
he put on a lot of
muscle last
year. And that's why
he
wasn't
up.
Explosive.
We'll see if that's the real.
You're not
reason.
Playing football, bro.
We'll see if that's the real reason why he wasn't as explosive, or if it's not that he's just you know. His knees are just betraying
him. It's not just a Dwayne Wade thing where he's just...
His knees are betraying him.
Hurting and not as good.
Yeah. I don't think he's as good as he was when they got him, but I still think he could be a key component of their team and be that second scorer when Melo's not on the court.
He's absolutely a key component to that team.
Imagine him getting feeds from Pablo Prigioni.
Who I really like.
Pueblo?
Yeah.
I really like everyone on this team, even Kurt Thomas.
Yeah, there's no Sheldon Williams.
Kurt Thomas is the Sheldon Williams. But Kurt Thomas gives you 7 better minutes a game than
Sheldon Williams ever did. Even though he was drafted, what,
and Kurt Thomas is, you know, I really love the addition of Ronnie Brewer. Sometimes he gets a little 3-happy from the corner, but he really doesn't look to score. He just plays D.
Ronnie Brewer gets 3-point Feltonitis?
Even the Feltonitis, there haven't been that many Feltdowns this year.
Chicago looked kind of like
a Feltdown.
It was a Feltdown.
But he had to. There was no Melo. And with Melo out, the offense really falls on.
He could have looked to pass more, and he definitely went.
He was trying to take over the game, and I can't kill him for it.
Nah.
With no Melo, who else are you going to? J.R. Smith was brutal.
Yeah, he had one field goal like the first half or something?
He's been bricking, but he's hot and cold. J.R. Smith's going to be cold for a couple more games. J.R. Smith's been cold for a few games now. Even the game he hit the game winner, he didn't have a great game shooting. He could come out tomorrow and go 8-for-10 from the floor against the Nets, and everyone he runs hot and cold. That's why he comes off the bench.
He does, and he shoots, and he won't stop shooting if he's cold,
but
and he won't stop shooting if he's hot.
Woodson gives him the green light.
Yeah, and he gives him the hook when he needs to.
Exactly.
And you know,
I just can't wait for Shumpert.
Shump.
I'm done. I can't wait for Shumpert to come back.
Yeah. When the defense gets better.
Yep, the defense.
It gets better
but
than
their best
Jason
perimeter
comes
defender
off the bench with Amari.
But regardless of Kidd coming off the bench, think about just the different rotations you could have where you have Kidd at the point and Shump at the two. That front court defense, in terms of Jason Kidd's ability to
steal
and create turnovers, and Shump's perimeter defense, that's a force.
Jason Kidd is pretty much one of those right time.
And you know what else we saw in the Nuggets game? What I saw Jason Kidd doing a lot more of than I've seen him this year? He was posting a lot.
He was looking for his shot. He's gone to the
He went back out to him on the three.
He was posting up a lot, and I haven't seen him do that, and it was creating a lot. And you know what? Before I forget this,
he took 28 free throws.
When was the last time you've seen the Knicks, out of a timeout, run an amazingly efficient play? That double handoff alley-oop to Tyson Chandler was a fucking phenomenally executed and thought-out play.
Drawn up.
Last year with D'Antoni and previous years, I feel like he didn't even draw anything on the goddamn clipboard, D'Antoni.
He just went to the clipboard and wrote win.
Yeah, I mean, Mike Woodson is a coach. And I don't know. D'Antoni is just...
Mike Woodson is Tone Loke.
He is.
Oils up that goatee of his.
Wow, dang.
Ow.
All right, well...
All right, Pat, give us an update.
Let me hit you with the update at 10:30. 30 minutes to go left in the show. Tweet us, add on deck show, your opinions on what we've said about the Knicks and the Heat and the Nets.
And cheese and blowjobs.
Where you think the Nets, the Knicks, and the Heat will end up at the end of the season. Do you think the Knicks are legitimately a force in the Eastern Conference? Are you worried about the Heat? Let us know. Gotta tell us these things, people. Come on. NBA action from yesterday. The Clippers beat the Raptors 102-83. The Bucks beat the Nets 97-88. Thunder over the Pacers 104-93.
I got the Fox.
Knicks with a comeback in the fourth, win 112-106. Melo drops 34 in that game. Knicks still undefeated at home. Magic beat the Suns 98-90, and the Jazz over the Lakers 117-110. Today, like we mentioned before, we had an overtime game. The Spurs over the Rockets right now 130-122 with 205 left in overtime. Lynn with 36 and 7.
20 bucks as he airballs the game winning.
Can you guess who leads the Spurs in points?
Danny Green.
Gary Neal.
Okay.
With 29.
Gary isn't a basketball name.
Mavericks. Gary Payton. Mavericks over the Kings, 102-79. There's 6:24 left in the fourth, and the Kings have scored 12 points total. Early in the game, Trailblazers over the Raptors, 16-15. Sixers beat the Pistons, 104-97. Warriors, 104-96 over the Bobcats. And the Heat beat the Hawks. That recently went final, 101-92. In the NFL right now, the route is still on in Foxborough.
Fuck.
Patriots, 28-0 over the Texans.
Fuck.
Tom Brady with four touchdowns.
Who's the other one to?
No.
I don't know. Four touchdowns.
I'm gonna lose my fantasy week because that fucking homo.
The Broncos win 26-13 on the Thursday night game, 8 in a row for Denver. Peyton Manning, 310 yards, one touchdown.
Dude, seriously, Matt Schaub, you can't just throw one touchdown. Shh. Just get one touchdown.
Rams over the Bills, 15-12. Cowboys 20-19 on a late second field goal. Browns 30-7 over the Chiefs. The Colts 27-23 over the Titans. Vikings win 24-14 over the Bears. The Chargers finally show up and play a decent game. Beat the Steelers in Pittsburgh, 34-24. Eagles win over the Buccaneers, 23-21. Redskins beat the Ravens as Kirk Cousins punches in the tying touchdown.
Another rookie quarterback.
Send them to overtime, 31-28. Panthers lose to the Falcons, 30-20. I'm sorry, Panthers beat the Falcons, 30-20.
Which is ridiculous.
Yep. The Jets over the Jaguars, 17-10. 49ers lose to the Dolphins 27-13. The Giants win 52-27. The Seahawks win 58-0. And the Packers over the Lions 27-20 in the snow. And there's your update, boys.
There it is. All right, so baseball.
Baseball.
Let's talk hot stove. Let's talk about Zach Greinke being the most overpaid pitcher in the history of baseball.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about him getting $25 million a year, whatever it is, to be good, but not great.
No. I mean...
No.
He's
dude,
got a 3.45 ERA.
Which is good, but not great. That's what he is.
Think about it. If you had one game to play, Is Zach Greinke in your top 15 for pitchers you would want on the
He's
Hill?
He's not in my top 30 for pitchers I want on the Hill.
100%, and you're paying him the second most money in baseball next to CC Sabathia.
For a pitcher.
CC Sabathia is in my top 10.
Oh, absolutely.
One of the man in one game.
Zach Greinke, you're just not worth that money. This is the Dodgers just saying, hey, fuck it, let's spend it right now. Yeah, like. You're dumb.
They just keep giving
honestly,
out money.
And this isn't even me being a Mets fan, I would rather them not have traded with the Dodgers, but they would have been better off getting Dickey than Zach Greinke, in my opinion.
Well, I mean, the Yankees just got Kuroda for 1 year, $15 million.
Which, you know what? That I even said, that might be overpaid, but he's better.
He had a lot better year than...
That's what I'm saying.
Greinke did.
No, the Dodgers... I'm saying if the Dodgers had instead traded for Dickey with the Mets, which I wouldn't have wanted as a Mets fan anyway... They would have made out better than signing Greinke for fucking $147 million over, what is it, 6 years?
Has an opt-out after three as well. Which is
that was the concession point. Instead of going for 7 years, they gave him the opt-out and went six.
That's just, I mean, look, they have a diesel rotation now, but to even put them in the, they're not even a top five rotation to me. Even with him.
No.
It's Kershaw, him, Kershaw, Greinke, Billingsley, Ryu, whatever.
Ryan.
Yeah.
Jin Fon.
I don't know. It's Korean. He's like the best pitcher in South Korea. And cool. You know, like, never mind. Like, all right, even if, like, best case scenario, it ends up like Yu Darvish, who had a good year. Again, good, not great. But,
a lot of strikeouts.
Yeah. But I doubt that happens. Forward. And then who else do they have? Do they still have they don't still have Capuano, right?
They do have Capuano, Harang, Lily, Kershaw.
Yeah, see, like that. Still, there's nothing. The Nationals have a better rotation. The Giants have a better rotation. I'd say the Phillies still have a better rotation.
Yeah, it depends on Roy Halladay.
Yeah, who else has a better rotation than them now?
Now that the biggest pitching piece in the offseason for the MLB has fallen, we can focus on, you know, the outlying guys and how they're going to move.
And on really awesome Dickey.
Well, besides Ari Dickey, in terms of players the Mets can sign to put into their rotation, do you think they're looking for starting pitching help, or are they looking more for offense right now? And
offense.
And outfielding. Not in terms of what they're trading Dickey for, in terms of the free agent market.
No, they've even said, I'm pretty sure that I've heard from quote-unquote Mets sources, that even if they trade Dickey, they're going to fill that hole internally with a Henry Mejia or Jeurys Familia to take the five slot. But I think if they trade Dickey, they should sign a guy like John Lannon for cheap.
I think they should sign a guy like Eric Bedard for cheap. Eric Bedard had a decent year last year for Pittsburgh. He's just hurt all the time. It's like the same type of gamble they had with Chris Young. When he's in there, he's effective, but, you know.
But Chris Young got hurt
be there. Exactly.
On the gambles, too, you know. Exactly. Like that's why I'm saying John Lannon is he's going to have a 4 ERA. Yeah. But he's going to get you innings, and as a 5 starter, whatever.
You're right.
You know, because then you can even keep him on as a long reliever or something. But either way, all right, let's go back to Ari Dickey, because that's the hot thing in baseball right now is what's going to happen with Ari Dickey.
Let's go to where Ari Dickey won't be going, and that's Kansas City.
Okay, yeah, fair. Because the Mets lost out on Will Myers, people.
Yes, the Royals acquire James Shields and Wade Davis from Tampa Bay for 4 prospects, including Will Myers
and Jake Odorizzi.
Odorizzi. Those are the two headliners of the deal.
That's the two big ones.
But beyond even the quality of the prospects, the Rays turn 2 players who they have who are basically on the back end of their team control
and
turn them into 4 players who they have under team control
7 years.
6 or 7 years.
Yeah. And they managed to, they dealt their second or third best pitcher in Shields, who is now the Royals' best pitcher.
Yeah.
And Wade Davis, who was pitching out of the bullpen for them.
Yes. And their starting rotation is still great.
Exactly.
They still have Helix, and they still have Moore. They still have Price. They still have Cobb.
And they have arguably the best hitting prospect in baseball.
Yeah. He was the player of the year last year.
You know, like that's...
You want to hear his numbers from last year in the minor leagues?
They're disgusting.
Yes. He hit .323 with 37 home runs and 109 RBIs.
That's okay.
He's the number one...
That's awesome.
Number one outfield prospect in all of baseball. Best hitting prospect in... all of baseball.
Lose B.J. Upton, win Will Myers.
I think That's an upgrade. B.J. Upton got a lot of money. He's really not that good. He's not.
No.
He plays solid defense, and he hits home runs.
He's a player who you get because you know what you're getting from him. Yeah. He's going to steal 30 to 40 bags. He's going to hit 20 home runs, but he's going to hit 240 or 250.
Yes.
And he's going to play good defense.
Yes.
He's consistent is what's best about him. But they get a guy who's another cornerstone to Evan Longoria,
mm-hmm.
who, you know, I think he's overrated personally, but still, when he's on the field, he's good. He's a cornerstone. And they have Will Myers, too.
And they get Odorizzi, who's
even
the,
if, even
the
if Odorizzi,
30th ranked prospect
yeah, even
in all
if
baseball.
He projects to a three starter.
He's a two.
Let's just say
Odorizzi,
three. Let's
yeah.
just let's say,
I don't think Odorizzi
let's say
that.
Conservative. Conservative, he's a three. They're, like, that's unbelievable that they can add him to the rotation a year or two from
yeah,
now.
No, but if you look at Odorizzi's stats, he's not... I don't think he's really that as big a deal as everybody makes.
Well, they also got Mike Montgomery, who's the number 10 overall left-handed pitching prospect in all of baseball.
Oh, that guy was also included in the deal.
Yes.
See, so look, like...
They trade rate.
But people are killing the Royals, and I don't think the Royals did that bad. I think...
No.
The Royals have prospects that were prospects that are now Alex Gordon, Hosmer. They
exactly.
have players who are there now.
They have former Will Myers.
And the gap... from their players that are there now to their prospects is huge.
They need to
not win now. I'm not talking about winning a World Series, but
winning
they need
season.
To be more competitive because their prospects that they had years ago are now maturing to their players, and the gap between them and Will Myers and those type of guys is too far, where when those guys get to the big leagues and are ready to contribute, Hosmer and Gordon are going to be gone.
Hosmer, Moustakas.
And Moustakas.
Will Myers is starting this year.
Oh, yes, probably.
Not going to start. He will be starting at one point this year.
Yeah, I mean, you never know. He might hit himself out of that in spring training. You don't know.
No, he's not going to break. He won't break camp with the team. Whatever team he was playing for, they wouldn't have because they would have lost a year of control for him.
Oh, okay. So
they're not going to break. Yeah,
you're
no.
saying by some at some point in the year,
I'd say
be
even don't be surprised if he's their starting center fielder in May.
Okay.
That early, you know.
All right.
But, like, I agree with you. The Royals didn't lose out that bad on this. Their team, if you factor in progression of their young players, and all their players are young. Salvador Perez, Billy Butler's still young.
Not very old.
No, he's not.
Johnny Giovatella at second.
Yeah, dude, they have a good
Alcides Escobar who's turning into a nice
Eric Hosmer,
solid shortstop.
People expected Eric Hosmer to be God sent to Kansas City last year, and he had a bad year, so who knows?
I think him and Moustakas both get better.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, you know? They could be... Their offense could be real good next year, and they're with a rotation that's contending. It's not great, but it's not bad at all.
I think the reason Kansas City was willing to give up Will Myers is because they have Bubba Starling in the pipeline.
Bubba.
Young 18, 19-year-old outfielder. 6'4", 180. Projects as a nice Drew Stubbs. A better version of Drew Stubbs.
Which I would take all day. If you gave me Drew Stubbs who could hit 270,
yeah,
I would take a Drew Stubbs that hits 270 all day.
You know? He had in his first year of pro ball, Bubba Starling, 371 on base. So
that's pretty nice.
It's already better than Drew Stubbs.
Oh, you got my boy up right now.
Yes.
All right, now what that does is that pretty much makes Ari Dickey the crown jewel of the pitching market right now.
And here's the guy right here
and
that the Mets are trying.
Apparently on the table, Mike Olt is a given. The Mets will get Mike Olt in a deal to the Rangers if they trade them Ari Dickey. They will, but that's not enough. It's a matter of what they get besides Mike Olt. Now, they offered the Rangers Dickey for Mike Olt and Leonis Martin, who's their number three hitting prospect, right behind Mike Olt, and both of them behind Jerickson Profar, who's awesome.
You want to hear Olt's numbers last year?
He's got a... Yeah, go.
398 on base percentage. 2882.
Yeah, what's his average?
288. 977 OPS.
But he struck out 100 times in 354 bats.
Yep, still young though.
He's 24. He's not. That's why the Mets should get more. He's a late coming prospect.
Went to college
with power.
Played 4 years at UConn
with power and a good eye. Bless you.
Thank you.
Except that he strikes out. So he probably strikes out swinging. I would assume he strikes out a lot, which is why he's just not worth Ari Dickey alone. Just flat out. Just.
You know what though? I think that might be your best offer you get for Dickey.
I think they'll get. I don't think they'll get Leonis Martin. Put it that way. If they could get if the Rangers said, yeah, we'll give you Mike Olt and Leonis Martin, the Mets should jump on it and just say yes, right there, ink it right there, because that's two outfield prospects or a corner infielder, outfield prospect, and an outfield prospect that can be in your outfield for the next at least 5 years. They're better than anything the Mets have right now.
I think you're overrating Leonis Martin. He's not even a top 10 Texas prospect.
Look at his numbers. Top 10. He's the number 3 hitting prospect for Texas.
Not according to this.
Where is he in that?
Not top 10.
By most other sources, he is. Look at. All right, go down. Let me see these guys' numbers. And let me compare him to Leonis Martin, who hit like 317 or 320 something. With
Jurickson Profar is number 1. Mike Olt's number 2.
Just look up Leonis
Martin. Okay, so I have a question for you. I'm going to give you 3 options. I want you to pick which one you want to happen. Do you want A, the Mets to re-sign R.A. Dickey?
Leonis Martin, not in the top 20.
The Mets to re-sign R.A. Dickey.
B, Leonis Martin's numbers.
B, the Mets to trade R.A. Dickey. Or C, to let him play out this year of his contract and see, go from there.
I think that
evaluating getting a deal done.
It's A or B. I've heard that what's going to happen is if they can't trade him, they're going to sign him. The reason that people aren't really like offering him a lot is because they're thinking that the Mets are bluffing that they can't sign him. But the Mets will sign him. They have the money to sign him. They have a deal on years. Dickey wants basically at least $13 million for each of the 2 years, which the Mets are willing to give him. He's totally worth that.
Yeah.
It's 100% worth that. Why wouldn't they give him $13, $14 million a year, $15 million a year? Because you know what? He still has trade value if you extend him.
He does.
He arguably has more trade value if you extend him, because then he's not just a rental.
Depends on the contract, though.
Well, I mean, I'm sure if the Mets traded Dickey, they would give whatever team
A window
to, just like they got with Santana, to negotiate.
Exactly. But what I'm saying is even if they extend him, don't be surprised if other teams are like, shit, they actually did it, and they say, you know what, we still want him, and we want him for that amount of money. You know, it's Dickey is going to be a valuable trade piece, whether he's signed or not.
They're gonna win whatever way they do it. If they sign him, they're gonna end up winning.
It's the Mets
winning.
They could fuck it up hard.
Yeah,
but right now they have the upper hand.
Yes, they do. Finally,
Leonis Martin last year 174 batting average and 52 play.
That's
appearances.
In the majors. Go to his minor league numbers. You know what Olt had? Worse numbers than that in the majors.
Oh, Olt got hurt.
He was also terrible in his at-bats in the majors. Look up Leonis Martin's MILB numbers.
All right, well, we know the Mets have to do something with Dickey, and hopefully by the time, since Zach Greinke has finally landed,
AAA, yeah.
Hopefully by the time we come here next week, nice. Dickey situation
same
will be
old.
Survived.
Yeah.
Solved.
But he's Cuban.
Dickey will either be signed.
Who knows how old he really is.
He'll be signed or, you know, traded by then.
Yeah. Oh, they also have an option. Toronto is still available to trade, but they have a lot of trade options right now. That's the thing. Right now, it's the Mets just need to play this right. It's not a hard play.
You know what you need to hope?
You need a top prospect plus one. That's it. That's it.
If you want Leonis Martin, you need to hope Josh Hamilton signs elsewhere, because Leonis Martin's starting in center field for them if he leaves.
Thank you for that, though, because Leonis Martin does look pretty good. And put it this way.
Well, okay, so let me
by his numbers in the minor leagues.
Let's move past R.A. Dickey and go to Josh Hamilton. Where do both of you quickly, so we can get into the Yankees quick?
Rangers.
There's nothing to get into with the Yankees.
Where do you think? Yeah, there is. I want to talk about where the old school Yankees have gone.
They're not. They're in the shitter. This team, the
all right. Well,
the team's
on.
Gonna.
I want you to answer my first question.
They're gonna miss the playoffs this year.
Where do you think Josh Hamilton will go?
Texas.
Because of like Scal mentioned last week, and like anybody who pays attention to MLB trade rumors would know, he's going back to Texas with whatever offer he gets for them to match it.
That's why the only other team that's making him an offer is Seattle.
You know, I mean, Yankees could surprise everybody and just.
If I was a team that wanted to sign Josh Hamilton, I'd sit down with him. I'd have a meeting. I'd say, here's our offer. As soon as you walk out that door, this offer's off the table.
Yeah, but because of that, I'm saying he's definitely in.
He's going to Texas.
Yeah, he's going to Texas.
You know, unless the Yankees trade Granderson.
Well, speaking of the Yankees, what's your, as a Yankee fan, you know, as Mets fans, we're used to frugal spending. As a Yankee fan, how do you feel about losing on bidding wars on Jeff Kepinger?
I don't think they ever made an offer to Jeff Kepinger.
I don't think they ever went.
I think they wanted Jeff Kepinger.
I don't think they wanted him that bad. That's how I look at that, too.
People say, oh, you lost a bidding war to Pittsburgh for Russell Martin. I just really don't think the Yankees wanted Russell Martin all that bad.
So, I mean, come on, bro. Right. They don't have anybody catching right now.
Yeah, but
they lost Eli Whiteside.
Yeah, but I'm going to look at that this way.
Eli Whiteside.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
There's still catchers on the market who aren't that good.
AJ
Pierzynski
hasn't signed
you don't need that good
yet.
Of a catcher. You don't need that good of a catcher, especially going to Yankee Stadium.
That's true, but Russell Martin provided a lot of home runs and clutch home runs.
No,
for the Yankees.
The guy hit 200 last year. I watched every game.
No, he did, but he did kind of.
See
when
you
he
later.
Did hit,
how many home runs
did
he have?
20. Yeah. All his, you know what all his home runs are? First row in right field.
Hey, a home run is a home run.
He strikes out more often than
that. But for that reason is why I think that even if they got a guy like, you know, Miguel Olivo or something, which is the Mets' top.
You're
going to
tell me they can't platoon two catchers and get the same production out of them that they got from Russell Martin?
What is the deal with Austin Romine?
He sucks. He's just like every other Yankee prospect. He's overhyped.
That sucks because that was the guy. That's pretty much the reason they traded Jesus Montero because they had Roman in the
No, they traded Jesus Montero because they want to get under 189. And they figured instead of spending all their money on pitching, they could use Pineda.
Who will be back this? You know what? Too nobody talks about that
because he's
going to
suck
this year. You don't know that.
No, I'll bet you Michael Pineda's out of baseball.
What do you think about? What do you think? You think Michael Pineda's out of baseball in 2 years? Yeah. I think we can't evaluate that trade. You never know; he could be a valuable piece.
Oh, this is it right here—the hottest Yankee topic right now.
How do you feel about Kevin Youkilis? Quickly,
if they sign him, I may renounce my Yankee fandom.
I've heard that.
Child, please.
I've heard this from numerous Yankee fans. He was legit the most hated Boston Red Sox.
He's my most hated Boston
Red Sox.
You don't think he would fit on your team?
I think he would fit well, but I hate him.
I mean, A-Rod might be gone till June.
A-Rod's not coming back this season.
Imagine the Mets sign Jimmy Rollins.
Yeah, there you go.
Imagine that.
You know, no. Would you want Chase Utley playing second base for the Mets? No, you wouldn't.
No, I would totally want Chase Utley playing second base.
If I got him
for
the price that you're about to get Youkilis for, yeah, I would.
I would not want Jimmy Rollins.
Yeah.
I just fucking hate
1 year, Youkilis. $12 million.
Yeah, then he comes and causes problems in the locker room.
I don't know about that. I mean,
tweet us what you think. Do you hate Youkilis so much?
Yeah, Yankee fans, what's your thoughts on Yuke?
Is it yes or no? Because personally, I think he's going to help the lineup. I mean, you lose A-Rod, you gain Yuke, who can also DH time to time, whatever.
I'd rather have Dante Bichette's kid playing it. Starting at third base.
Dante Bichette.
And Mets fans, tweet us, add on deck show. Let us know what you think, what they should do with R.A. Dickey. Keep him, sign him. Keep him and sign him, trade him, or let him play out his deal.
That's the thing. The Mets win either way with all that.
They do.
They really do. There's not a loss in that.
And surprisingly, besides the Mets, we know that's a win-win situation. It's been a very quiet offseason for the Yankees, and I think, you know, they're going into next year with a worse team. They're going into this season with a worse team than they had last year.
Yeah, but
their
the Yankees
team is not as good.
No, I agree with that. But the Yankees
Derek Jeter coming off ankle injury.
Swisher.
No A-Rod. No Swisher.
They lost 28 home runs from Swisher.
They lost Martin's home runs. They lost A-Rod's home runs. They lost. You know, you don't. Jeter's Jeter, but you still don't know coming off that ankle.
If Jeter hits 300, they're fine.
Two outfielders on the market that could go to either New York team and help either team. Cody Ross still out there.
Yeah.
And Delmon Young still out there.
Yeah, they have options. Although Delmon Young can't play in New York, man. Last time he was here, he was beating up Jews.
But that's who, all right, Cody Ross, ideal for the Mets right now, in my opinion, is if you can get, I mean, the best case scenario, absolutely. You get Mike Olton, Leonis Martin from the Rangers.
Yeah.
You go out and you sign either a free agent catcher, or you get Cody Ross, and you have a full outfield. There you go. Yeah. Then you fill that your outfield with major league players.
I mean, there's a lot
and
of
then
to be honest
you sign
with you,
a John Lennon and or bullpen help.
I think you're dreaming
you
if you think you're getting Olt and Martin.
I mean,
for a 30.
I don't think it's going
to
happen.
I also think that people were saying the same thing to us when we got Zach Wheeler.
Yeah, but also
this isn't the trade deadline, and Texas is an independent race.
Yeah,
right
but
now.
I'll also throw this out there. I would give up more than R.A. Dickey.
Yeah,
for
but
those
you
two.
Don't know. But you don't know that the Mets won't trade Dickey at the trade deadline.
Would you
trade R.A. Dickey and like Jurys Familia?
Yes,
for those two.
Yes.
Yeah, but that's
actually a feasible deal. Familia is a good pitcher.
You
driver,
yourself
not
said
great.
That. The what's the Leonis?
Yeah.
That is not that good.
I said I've never seen him play. I didn't say he wasn't that good.
Okay. Well, regardless, I think Dickey with Familia will get that trade done.
Either way, you know what
the Rangers losing out on Greinke, they're and if they sign Hamilton, they need Dickey.
Their pitching is buns.
It's slowly becoming buns from what it used to be.
There are pitchers on the market available.
There's nobody near as good as R.A. Dickey.
Kyle Loesch is available, and you
the
don't
Rangers
have to
like,
top
the
prospects.
Rangers are like the Yankees from years ago. They want to get the big name that's out there. They want that. They
yeah,
want
but they've
the
done
R.A.
so
Dickies.
Much to hold on
plus
to their
plus, the
R.A.
Dickey story would end perfectly in Texas.
I think if this Martin guy is as good as you say he is, they're not getting Martin in there.
I don't think they will either. But again, I would give up more than just
Darnell. I think that conversation starts with
Did
Zach
you think
Wheeler,
that really? The Rays would get what they got from the Royals for Shields and Davis?
Yes, because the Royals were desperate for a starting pitcher. Texas is not desperate for R.A. Dickey.
You don't know that. How do you know that Texas isn't desperate for another frontline?
Who's Texas's frontline? Who's their best starter right now?
Darvish.
That's not a good ace.
Yeah, that's not an ace. He's not an ace.
That's not good.
That's
your opinion.
Say they're not desperate.
That's numbers. He's not an ace.
He pitched pretty well last year.
He did all right last year.
Speaking from fantasy ownership.
A lot of Ks, a lot of innings. You got to assume he gets better.
We might be a couple minutes. This is heated.
All right.
Yeah, you have to assume he gets better. But
he had a 3.9 ERA through 190 innings.
Yeah.
221 strikeouts.
He's a K machine, but okay. Say he improves to a 3.5 ERA. Still not an ace. Still not an ace, bro. And then who comes after that?
Holland.
Who's not good. I don't care what everyone wants to say. He's not good.
Harrison, actually, probably.
Harrison is better than Holland. I'll give you that.
R.A. Dickey would be a perfect fit for them.
R.A. Dickey is their immediate ace.
I don't think
they're going to overpay in prospects for a 38-year-old.
I don't know that it would be overpaying, especially considering that the Mets could throw in another guy.
It's not like he's only been good this year.
No,
he was dominant this year. He was great last year, and he was good the year before.
3 years with the Mets, 2.95 ERA.
One thing I will say, though, is going to a hitter's ballpark in the American League.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to – but he also faces Seattle how many times a year?
It's still a better bet than anybody else in the market right now.
That ball flies out of that park. No.
The thing is, anybody coming to Texas has to deal with that. It's not just R.A. Dickey.
I'm just saying, though.
And that's the perfect weather for R.A. Dickey's knuckleball.
It's true.
You're right.
So, I mean, you know what? Yeah, he'll probably have games where he gets shellacked in that stadium, but he'll probably have games where he doesn't give up a fucking – he gives up two hits.
But Texas does have a lot of money, so I think they're looking to – go for maybe Kyle Loesch, Ryan Dempster back.
Put it this way.
If Jurickson Profar is going to start the year as the shortstop, then they're going to be able to trade Elvis Andrus or Ian Kinsler for a starting pitcher and not have to sacrifice their farm system.
They've said they won't trade Elvis Andrus. And put it this way, okay?
Ian Kinsler take Alt and Andrus for Dickey?
Not on my team.
I would take that.
You would, yeah.
I would take that.
You and the Rangers, you wouldn't do that?
I'm not the Rangers. I can't speak for what they would do.
Your opinion, if you were with the Rangers,
probably not.
You
I'd look to get rid of Kinsler instead.
I would take Kinsler. I'd take
Kinsler too, man.
I don't think the Mets are going to pay Kinsler. That's the thing. I don't think the Mets are going to trade R.A. Dickey.
Yeah, dude. The
for a guy they're going to have to pay.
If they're trading R.A. Dickey, getting Ian Kinsler and Olt, the Rangers will pay some of Ian Kinsler's salary.
Exactly. The Mets have the best trade chip in the market right now, except for Justin Upton, but that's not really going to happen.
Regardless if it does, he's not. R.A. Dickey is a better trade chip right now than Justin Upton.
Arguable.
Because of what's being demanded.
But also, Justin Upton's on a very friendly 3-year deal.
Yeah. And
R.A. Dickey's only going to cost you $5 million.
No, but you're going to have to re-sign him. So if you're only going to get him, if you're planning on getting R.A. Dickey as a 1-year rental,
you're
not getting.
Yeah, but if
the Mets
sign him to a 3-year deal and trade him at the deadline,
how much is his deal? Zach Greinke just got $164
million. R.A. Dickey is not getting over 15
is maximum.
He's worth $17 a year.
No, he's not.
He's not. He's not.
He came off a salary.
If he's worth $17 million a year, then how are you going to deny
on the
his
open,
trade value?
On the open market, R.A. Dickey could get $17
million.
But he's
not worth Alton Leonis.
Not if I'm Texas.
But he's worth $17 million.
In a bidding war, you don't think a team like L.A. is going to give him $17 million a year to get him?
And I think a team like Texas will give up those two type of prospects to get him.
I don't think they're going to give up their two best offensive prospects.
They're not. It's not their two best. It's their second and third.
Okay, their second and third. Well, Profar is going to start the year.
And according to you, and according to MLB.com, Leonis Martin isn't even in the top 20. So it's giving up the second best.
That wasn't MLB.com. That was some schmuck.
Whatever it was, it doesn't matter.
Okay, so the Mets are going to get.
You're conflicting your points right now.
We're not saying they're going to get them.
Mets fans, you heard it here first.
But. We didn't say that. They're going to get them.
We said that
R.A. Dickey's value is definitely worth those two players. We didn't say Texas is going to do this.
And he's worth those two players based on what you said.
Players.
No.
He's worth those two players based on what you said about Leonis Martin.
What did I say about Leonis
that,
Martin?
Oh, he's that not even top 20. I've never even heard of him.
I said I've never seen him play. I apologize.
How many Texas Rangers prospects have you seen play?
Two.
Old pro far.
Yeah.
So we're not here.
Well, Martin for
anyway, tweet us your thoughts on what should be done by both the Mets and Yankees and what has been done. Which
don't
is
tweet us
nothing.
On what you think the Yankees should do because they're not going to do it, so don't waste your time.
It's true, but then again, don't be surprised. They're the snake in the weeds.
You heard it here first. The Yankees will finish fourth place in the American League East this year. One
life of a fucking Yankees fan.
One spot ahead of the Boston Red Sox.
Tough life.
The Yankees. Tell me right now that the Yankees with the roster they're going into the season with right now are not
basically the same roster as last year.
Every team in that league got better except them.
They could easily make
the playoffs. Not really. The Blue Jays did. That's it.
Tampa didn't get better.
Baltimore didn't get better.
You just talked about how Tampa got better.
I talked about how Tampa got better
for the future.
And they have more players under their control for the future. Do I think Tampa is that much better this year? No, I don't. Do I think Baltimore is that much better this year? No, I don't. Do I think Boston is? No, I don't. Who'd they sign? Mike Napoli?
And
Shane Victorino. Shane Victorino.
Oh, my God. Book it. They're going to win 97
games. I said the Yankees would finish ahead of the Red Sox.
So yeah. I don't even think Toronto was better than the Yankees.
Everyone's better than the Yankees. They're not making the playoffs for next year.
Oh, my God. The life of a Yankee.
The pessimistic spoiled Yankee fan. He'll admit he's spoiled.
It's over. I'm spoiled as shit, okay?
And Yankee fans wonder why fucking people hate the Yankees.
I don't wonder why people hate the Yankees. People hate on our greatness.
No, we hate on your fans act.
Suck one. Let's move to picks because this is
we're running a little on deck over.
You know what the
right
Yankees
now?
Should have done? Signed Hamilton, signed Greinke, signed Loesch, signed Pierzynski. That's what the fucking Yankees do.
Whatever the Dodgers did, the Yankees should have done.
All right.
Print money in the fucking basement.
Go Athletics.
On deck, we're running into overtime right now.
Let's go Athletics.
Past 11, but we don't care. We're still going right now. We're going to do our picks for the week, and then we're going to wrap it up.
What are we cutting into? The fucking Pacey Prince Power Hour?
No, it's all right. That'll still run perfectly. Don't worry about the Pacey Prince Power Hour. So, Giants fan to my left. Giants, Falcons in Atlanta. Who you got?
I have the Giants winning.
Yes? What's your score?
No surprise. 35-31.
I think the Falcons win by a score that's very similar to what you just said. I just don't think the Falcons lose at home.
No. Falcons beat the Giants.
Okay.
Fair enough.
All right. Well, what
no
about
scores?
The...
No scores?
Well, I
35-28.
Yeah, I'm right with you. I'm saying, like, you know, maybe not even that high. 28-24.
Oh, well, who is? Oh.
28-24, something like that. All right, Jets-Titans in Tennessee. Monday night. Jets, one game out of the playoffs.
They're going to win because that's just them. They're going to beat Tennessee.
I'm with you.
I'm going to go with the same scores this week, 17-10.
I'm saying 21-17, Jets.
I'm going to say 17-10. I'm going to say Mark Sanchez throws a touchdown pass.
Yeah.
One.
Okay.
One touchdown pass.
21-17 Jets. Scala?
17-14 Titans.
Ooh, picking the Titans Monday night. I think the Jets are embarrassed as their last showing on national TV. I think they'll get the win. All right, so 49ers-Patriots.
Good game.
In Foxborough. Good game. After what New England's doing to Houston tonight, I mean, it's hard to pick against them.
That's what I was going
to
say.
But I think the 49ers are going to win that game, and I think they're going to win 24-21.
I'm going to go with the opposite. I think that the Niners are going to that the Patriots could win again based on this week.
Yeah.
I thought the Texans were going to not necessarily whoop the Patriots, but I thought it was going to be an easy win.
Where's that game?
It's not happening
in Foxborough.
I think that San Fran's going to lose it. I think the Pats are going to win. It's hard to say 30 something cuz San Fran's D is good.
Yeah,
but I'm going to say it 31 to 20 fucking 1.
Wow, 10-point win?
Yeah.
Scala, what do you have to say?
Patriots 28-14.
28-14. Interesting, interesting. Well, for you now, let's start with you. Steelers-Cowboys in Dallas, the house that Jerry Jones built.
Not to be confused with Jerry Brown.
Not to be confused.
Both teams are 7-6, battling for a wild card spot.
Cowboys 21, Steelers 17.
Mike?
You know what? I'm going to go opposite that with Pittsburgh winning. 21-17, Pittsburgh.
I think Pittsburgh wins 20-14.
I think Big Ben.
Yeah.
And the Steelers D step up.
Big Ben.
I hope so.
All right. Now, I got...
Oh, yeah.
Let me give you two more games here. Mike, I'm going to give you one. Scal, I'm going to give you the other.
Right? How good is it?
I'm going to give you the other one.
All right.
Mike, I want you to tell me who wins Colts-Texans.
Who wins? Colts, Texans.
Yep.
Texans, because they're losing now, and they're not going to lose two in a row, especially not to Indy. I think that Houston's going to win that. Yeah, 27 to fucking to 18 to 17.
You have the Texans winning?
Yeah.
Houston. And Scala, your game.
Yeah.
Broncos at the Baltimore Ravens.
Broncos.
Broncos, what's the score?
After Ravens?
Manning only, Peyton Manning has 30 touchdowns this year.
Peyton Manning is the MVP of the NFL.
28-17.
I'm with you on the Broncos. Yeah.
And my final pick, Packers-Bears. I have the Packers winning 28-14.
The Packers beat the Bears.
28-14. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for listening to another episode of On Deck on White Hot Media Radio.
Tweet us at On Deck Show all week.
I'm sorry.
And also like our Facebook page, Facebook.com.
Like us on Facebook.
Yeah, like us on Facebook, Facebook.com/OnDeckLive. Tweet us at On Deck Show throughout the week. We tweet back. You know, we'll get the conversation. We'll get the debate going. Remember, what did we talk about today? We tell people to tweet us. I'm with cheese or I'm with BJ's. Let us know where you stand. You're giving up cheese.
We're with cheese.
We're with cheese.
We keep cheese.
Let us know what's more exciting than watching a Jet game. A lot of things.
A lot. Let us know who you think is worse than Mark Sanchez.
True.
And
anything else you want to tell us?
Send us dick pics.
Yeah.
He finally said yes.
And hopefully
he finally said yes.
Next time we meet, the Knicks tape will still be rolling. The Jets will be less than a game from the playoffs.
And the Giants will be a further game removed from the rest of the pack.
Yeah, hopefully
NFC
for
here.
Your health, because I feel like the Giants are just going to have a terrible, terrible game for some reason.
I feel like I might rip my own dick off by the end of the season.
All right. And stay tuned. Up next, the Pacey Prince Power Hour.